Right, we probably want to do introductions first, because it's a wee bit busier than it normally would be. So let's start for you, Connor. We'll go round the room.
Okay, I'm Connor, and I'm unlikely to make a great deal of sense to just now. I've not quite put my thoughts together yet. I'm still feeling quite emotional.
You're drinking heavily.
I've already hit the 7.5% cider. So
you had to take the cloudy one that's like rocket fuel.
But anyway, still feeling it a little, but that's supporting Hibs. It's tough. I'll pass you on to my brother Thomas, who's
I came along for this first time on podcast, and I'm on the Copperberg, so that's much better.
We're introducing ourselves by our drink.
It says something about the result of the game, I think. Yes. That our opening gambits are more focused on the drink. Okay, let's keep the introductions moving.
I'm Kevin, I'm Mikey's brother. I'm also on the Copperberg, and like Connor, just try to get it all together. Disappointing, but not like last year.
Mikey, you'll be bored of my voice with a few podcasts in the past. And yeah, just sort of kind of drinking in the reaction and sort of how it all feels. I'd say we definitely felt worse in the past than maybe this time last year, so yeah.
I'm Craig, I'm the heartbroken suicidal one. Staying on the coke so I don't overdo it too much.
And I'm Sam, and I'm your host as usual, and the lone Jambo in the room, as I was, I think, probably in the stadium. I was maybe the only one that braved it. Craig, needless to say, stitched me up and as close to section 43 as he could possibly get me, so I'm still kind of recovering from the shock to the system of that. So in general, we just want to get the reaction while it's still as raw. We'll firstly focus on today, and then we'll start to open it up to this season in general, and then maybe on to a wee bit of the summer and where Hibs go from here. I nearly said where we go from here, but I knew that Craig would cool me up. I was talking about the Royal League, of course.
Dropped in a couple of wee's during the game as well.
Again, they were of the Royal sense, although then I should have been in the Rangers end. Anyway, Connor, what were your thoughts on, obviously we've not discussed Wednesday either, so we'll start with today and we can reference how Wednesday impacted how today went. What were your thoughts on how Hibs set up today?
I was surprised to see the same lineup as Wednesday, more or less, you know, with McGeoch obviously making an inclusion for the only change of the match. But really, I think the first 20 minutes is where we could have seized control of the game. You know, it was looking really positive. That first 20 minutes of the match is how we should have played on Wednesday, and unfortunately, just again, lots of chances but not quite taking them. It was encouraging to see in the second half Stubbs just sort of throwing caution to the wind, bringing on four strikers. Not exactly a classic lineup of strikers, it's not going to be the new famous five by any means, but it was good to see us at least going hell for leather. I actually think that this game was more or less dominated by Rangers tactics, by their spoiler tactics. I think in terms of how they played, they had to exert, you know, they had to work hard, but they had to exert the minimal amount of creativity. There was a lot of pressing, very, very defensive, not even much in the way of counter-attacking, and that kind of set the tone for the match after initially sort of hairy 20 minutes. I think Rangers, you could kind of see the way the game was going, unfortunately, from then on. I guess we'll talk about the emotional side of things, but it was quite an emotional day for a Hibs fan, I guess, from the outset, with that Piper coming on the pitch to do the minute silence for the train crash. I think that was something I wasn't expecting. It had somehow slipped my notice that was going to happen, and that was quite a sort of spine-tingling moment, I think. And then the end of the game, we'll probably talk about celebrating defeat and whatnot, but I think people were feeling different from how they felt this time last year. You know, it's obviously a big blow, it was a tough match to watch, but I think people are feeling a bit more pride in their team than they were at this stage last season. Well, definitely more.
Okay, let's open it up to a bit of general discussion about Alan Stubbs' performance over the games then. Connor's mentioned there that he felt that McCall maybe dominated tactically, not necessarily by making great decisions, but that, you know, those kind of negative tactics sort of suited the way that the game played out over the two games. Is there anyone who feels like, Alan Stubbs made major mistakes, or just that he maybe has a few things that he could learn for the future?
I think Stubbs' biggest mistake is he didn't reinforce the squad enough in January. That's obviously been pretty clear with, you know, now that Forster's out injured, we've only got two centre-halves in Hamlin and Fontaine. There's no one else that can really step back into that. You know, my preferred formation's the three at the back. There's no one else that can go in there when Forster's injured. And even Boyle was a good signing to bring in, but I don't know, maybe the money on JJ could have maybe went for another centre-half, or tried to maybe use it a bit better, because he's not really done a great amount since he's come in, rather than being maybe Laddie's favourite player. That's pretty much all I can say about the impact that he's made.
What does he like so much about it?
I asked that in the game, thinking, and it was that he can pronounce his name.
It's only JJ, it's the only one he can properly pronounce. Malonga, nut. Cummins, nut. What? Don't like his
El Alagui, most of us can't pronounce
it. I'm still not convinced we've got that right. I think it's El Alagui, apparently, but I'm not committing to that on a regular basis.
Ask him on Twitter. The big miss
for me, I don't think Stubbs has a plan B when plan A isn't working. He tries to persist with it. You know, the way that we started today was how we should have started on Wednesday, but we still didn't, apart from McGeoch in for Robertson, there was no change in the setup of the team. You can almost say that McGeoch is almost a like-for-like replacement for Robertson. He's maybe not that dynamic defensively, and he offers a wee bit more going forward, but there's still not that much different between the two of them, I don't think.
Major decisions, like, there's nothing going into the two games that I think could have really drastically changed things. Obviously the shape was limited by, like I touched on, the availability of centre halves, and with hindsight, yeah, we could add one in January. We've got two injured just now, obviously Watson and Forster both could have played in that third centre half role. Obviously relatively unfortunate that both are injured, especially Forster on the last day of the season, when he's missed most of the season as it is. So yeah, you might go further back as a season review. Yeah, we could have done things differently in January. In terms of the lineups for the game itself, I think it had to be a back four. There was no other alternative, unless, you know, Alagui, for example, is secretly a decent centre half as well that can be used at set pieces, but I don't think that's the case. There wasn't any options. Personnel in the midfield, you're end up tossing a coin between who comes in and out, between McGeoch, Robertson, Fivey, Liam Craig. I think Liam Craig certainly didn't let anybody down with his performances over both games, so I don't think you can sort of point the finger at him being made a scapegoat once more like he was a year ago. The diamond shape was led by the personnel available. You can obviously continue to debate the striker situation. I personally was quite happy to see Malonga and Cummings start both matches. I felt that it seems as though El Alagui didn't have 90 minutes in him, so I think it's better to bring him into the game to change things up, rather than at some point during the match lose the strength that he brings to the team. So I don't think that Cummings and Malonga has particularly got sort of game-changing abilities coming on as subs. So I don't disagree too much with it. I would have said today that when we had the four strikers on the park, I felt we still overplayed in midfield. You bring four strikers in the park, a couple of which are quite handy in there. You just need to bombard it. Like, there's no point in pretense and sort of sticking to a level of your beliefs in how the game should be played. If you've stuck four strikers on, to me that's an intention of, we need to absolutely bombard these guys. They had three centre halves, they had a wee small right back, and they had Lee Wallace playing at left back, who still had to keep a wee eye on David Gray. So I think there was an opportunity to try and overload in that situation. Unfortunately, we'd left ourselves light in midfield with guys moving into the box to try and get off these knockdowns. So that's the thing with things that I probably would have changed that slightly. And when we went with the four up top, utilising the four of them instead of overplaying at the back in midfield, I think that it would have taken a hell of a lot of concentration for Rangers for half an hour to defend a constant aerial bombardment.
Okay.
And it's not necessarily our kind of sort of belief in how we want to play, but there's a need must situation. I think that was it.
I think Fraser Fivey was a good example of that. He played really well, but it was a lot of nice dribbling, nice passing, but
well, it wasn't necessarily needed at the time.
Yeah, exactly. It wasn't bad play per se, but it was just maybe we needed something a bit more pressing.
Let's open that up then as a question for the new boys. Let's get you settled in here.
Wee brothers.
talking about Alan Stubbs and his sometimes stubbornness with his plan A. But today was a situation where we had to see some sort of plan B. What were your thoughts generally on the plan B and the way it was implemented?
Plan B, it had to be done. If we wanted to have a chance of getting through this, then we had to flood their defence with our own players. Like the two guys already touched on, at times we were just a bit too, relaxed in the midfield when really we should have been piling forward and just getting every opportunity as possible to get into the box and cause them problems. He at least did, get the four guys on, but like Michael said, at times they're still playing it around the back and looking to try and find, Alan was trying to do his Hollywood pass maybe too often when really he should just put it in the air and let the guys battle. But yeah, at times it has seemed like plan A, when it doesn't work, it can maybe kill the game, but we're still lucky in that we do have guys on the bench who can maybe come into the team, it's still the same shape, still the same idea, but they can maybe do something a little different. So there's something there to build on. But yeah, I could say just a little too late when it all sort of came together.
Did we get to a point where we maybe, there was a danger where there was simply too many strikers on the park?
I think so, yeah. There was two or three people going for the same ball, particularly in the last 10 minutes, and slightly getting in each other's way, but we just had to do that. We had to have everyone up front and just push as much as possible.
I think there was an instance where I remember Malonga and Cummins both going for the same ball, and you're like, come on guys, you should really have a bit more of an understanding of what each other's going to do by this point. But I don't necessarily think it was a mistake to have all the strikers on, but I do think, as Mikey said, we could have utilised it a bit better.
We'd probably be sitting here complaining if they hadn't put those strikers on the park, so
I think everyone after Wednesday night was complaining that he had stuck with the same two strikers.
Yeah. So that's what I was at this point about Wednesday. He didn't make any subs. He made one sub and he didn't change any of the forwards, when really on Wednesday Cummins particularly had a really poor match, and you thought, even like I said, Alagui might not be fit, but even throwing JJ for 20-25 minutes just to offer something different. So at least he noticed that, he saw it very early on and put Alagui on, and then I don't know how long it was left, but he put on JJ as well, and just, it was kind of, like I said at the time, a Jimmy Collingwood tactic, just get everyone on and just try and get a goal. And so he at least saw the change there, and it sort of worked. It didn't help that there was six defenders back, so even if we don't get in our own way, there's still two Rangers players, Oliver Cummins, there's two in Malonga, McCulloch's battling with Alagui, so it can work and it doesn't work at the same time.
I think for a lot of the game as well, we seem to be playing with two at the back for a lot of the time. Yeah. It was Hamlin and Fontaine at the back, and I was concerned that maybe that's going to cause us a problem if they attempt a counter-attack, but that didn't seem to cause us any problems at all. So it did seem to be the midfield where we were just getting too slowed down and not getting enough effective balls into the box.
I think Scott Allen's trying to do it all himself far too much as well. Mm-hmm. I think that's, it's obviously a personal thing because he wants to try and drive us forward, but there's times where the easy passes, the simple pass is the easiest one to make. There was too many times, it was about 5 minutes to go, and he tried that. I think Gray was going down the right and the easy pass was to slip it in, and he tried to whip one round the defence, and it's like I'm watching it and I know that no one else, Malonga, Cummins, Farid, JJ, none of them can see that coming. So why is he even attempting it?
When they've got those four guys on, the simplicity of the game should have been that Alan's hanging with the 18-yard box waiting for the knockdown, and it's Fontaine and it's Hanlon who are knocking in those flighted balls. A professional player can flight a ball into a penalty box for the halfway line, and it should have been that the midfielders, one sitting in front of the centre-halves, but the rest of them just in and around the penalty box. Because Farid won his fair share when he did come on, but anything that was in his general direction, he's either getting a fair share or he was forcing the centre halves at Rangers to not fully clear the ball. So I think that this sort of use of plan B just didn't quite get there, and I think that Alan's usefulness sitting on the halfway line, he can't thread a ball through 10 Rangers players from the halfway line. It just needs to be flighted in. I mean, he could have been more useful taking up somebody from that penalty box, marking him, or he did a bit of damage out wide. He quite a few times beat Forster and got a decent ball in. So I think that just it almost requires Stubbs to go get yourself where it matters. You don't have to be the guy that flights in a simple ball, because he obviously wasn't really picking that option very often as well. So I think she'd be left to Fivey or McGeoch with the centre-halves. I would have bombed Liam Fontaine up earlier as well.
I think personally that's where an element of criticism could come into it in terms of the plan B, is that Alan Stubbs went with a classic plan B, the Jimmy Calderwood plan B, that let's get as many strikers on as possible. That is the conventional plan B, and everyone will sit outside that and say, well, Stubbs did what he had to do, you can't really blame him for the fact that Bond never fell. But I think you can argue that maybe he should have had a plan B that better suited the players who were also still on the park, and that for Hibs, a plan B that sees them completely miss out the midfield isn't he really a viable one. It might have got them through, but as we were saying, the game then goes to extra time. What do you do now? Now that it's back to a normal, you know, it's 0-0 and you've got half an hour to win it, you would have had to go with the same thing, because that doesn't function within the manner that Hibs play the game. I do wonder if there's a slight criticism that it seemed to be, we're playing normally, now there's a million strikers on. There was no kind of middle transition ground. There was no, like, let's keep the ethos that we have, let's stick to the way that we play football, but let's do it in a slightly more gung-ho fashion. I thought it was a big leap, and because of that, I thought, and it's one thing that I wanted to ask you guys, in terms of the actual implementation of the plan B, I thought the only time Rangers looked like scoring was just after those subs had been made, and Scott Allen didn't have a clue where he was supposed to be.
Stevenson Fontaine got drawn to left back.
Stevenson, Allen went in, but wasn't he quite sure if he was supposed to be there, so didn't he track back. Fontaine got dragged miles out of position, and Rangers nearly scored with a ball across the face. And I thought, had that gone in, Alan Stubbs would have come in for major criticism.
Absolutely.
Because that was a wee bit schoolboy.
It was like, there wasn't a communication. I had to explain to the guys in the park what had changed and whose role had changed.
Well, Alan didn't have a clue. Alan's looking at Fontaine and he's like, where did I go?
Exactly what I said. Like, whoever
what
the sub,
am I supposed to do?
Like, it's a small ground. Like, somebody could have been dragged over, or the sub coming on, Fontaine, like, you tell those three guys what they're now doing. But it seemed like
in the rush of wanting to
change the personnel, there wasn't that great communication of how we're going to orchestrate the new system.
That's the thing for me. It felt like it was improvised. Oh. It felt like it was, I would have expected, maybe it's too much to expect, but I would have thought that in the approach to this game, you know, yesterday, they would have sat down, they would have said, if we've still no scored after 60, this is the likely change that we'll make. If we've still no scored after 70, this is the likely change that we'll make. And the guys then just know and they adjust and they've prepared for it. That felt like it was completely on the hoof today. And as a result, there was times where guys had their hands out to their side saying, well, I can't do anything if I've no idea where I'm supposed to be.
I would have had Alan just sitting out wide, because to me that's where he was doing his most dangerous work, was getting the ball in a wider, even in the channel, rather than right on the touchline, and either drawing out one of the fullbacks, getting past them, or cutting back inside and just floating a ball in. But like I said, he sat in the middle of the park, just too deep to influence anything, so I'd black it up his backside. And they're still chasing about in that kind of area where a couple of the fielders, they hadn't dropped so deep. So I just think that the strategy and how we were going to play that shape just didn't really seem to either be thought out in advance, or if it had been, it wasn't communicated onto the park, and the players didn't have the presence of mind to think, right, we've discussed this, or obviously the discussion never took place in the first place, but you would have hoped that there would have been like a kind of sit down going, we will need to change in this fashion. They've had time to prepare, like, even before Wednesday, they could have sat and went, if this happens on Wednesday and going into Saturday, this is how we'll play. I just felt like there wasn't that depth of planning. I'm going to be honest, I don't think they anticipated losing 2-0 at Ibrox, which is a bit of a ludicrous sort of assumption to make, given that they beat us east of the road.
Well, that's the difficult thing with having an 18-day break before the game, but then only having like two real training days between the games, as you've got all this to build up to the first game. If the first game was a complete curveball that no one saw coming, you've then only got 2 days to readjust, and I think that was maybe a problem. While we're still on Stubbs, the last point I want to make on him, his confidence, his bravado, I think the Hibs fans have really taken to it, because it's the polar opposite from what they've felt for a very long time and from what they've seen in the dugout at points. They've looked and saw someone who they weren't really convinced knew what he was doing, or that he was even confident that he had the answer to it. Whereas Stubbs, even defiantly sometimes, seems to think I've got the answer to this. Mm. Is there any chance that going into these games that actually his confident demeanour actually didn't necessarily serve him that well? I know he had been on the television coverage for the Queen of the South game, watching BT Sport before the game on Wednesday. It was said that by the pundits who said, you know, standing next to him on Sunday, he is supremely confident that Hibs will come here and win. That can then take the wind out of the sails even more when you don't, and when you lose 2-0. And it was it more a wake up call than it needed to be? Had Hibs maybe been a wee bit more cautious? Had Alan Stubbs not gone into his press conference and said, we've prepared for four games, now we're back? Connor, what do you think?
There is still like a spadeful of naivety in Stubbs' management. As you said, he's still incredibly popular with the Hibs fans, and you know, you saw that as he was applauded off today. But you have to accept that this is the end of his first year in management, and it's been quite a chaotic year at times. You know, that naivety, I think, after Wednesday night's game was quite apparent, where, as you mentioned, Sam, he looked pretty shell-shocked after the match. Like, he hadn't been expecting this at all. It was a real slap in the face. And there are certain elements of this game which, you know, can be seen as quite positive. He seems to have a blanket refusal to criticise his team, at least in public, which seems to annoy people a bit. But you just kind of wonder if that, on occasion, maybe borders on mild delusion, where you sort of wonder if that transfers to the team. Where
it's difficult to also, with many managers, to decipher if there's a difference between their public persona, yeah, and what they're like in the dressing room, in their office, or on the training ground. He might not be the player's best pal on the training ground, but it's one of these things you'll never really know unless we kind of know a great deal about what goes on in there.
I think if Stubbs is like interviews throughout the season, he's more of a, as much as he's their manager, he still wants to be their pal as well. When you hear the stuff like, you know, if any of my players are in trouble at 2-3 in the morning, kind of, if they're in trouble for any reason, whether it be personal or whatever, I want them to give me a phone. And that seems that comes across as a bit, you're granted you want to be there for them as people, but at the end of the day, they're professional footballers, you know, they're adults. You shouldn't be getting a phone call at 2 in the morning.
But in theory, I think that can work as long as you've then got an assistant who can go through the players if need be. Normal, it's not the conventional way that turns the normal relationship around. Normally you've got an assistant who can go in and put the arm around the guy after he's, yeah, you know, had the hairdryer treatment from the manager.
It's got a change in modern managers, and that, like, I watched a thing on Sky a couple of weeks ago, and it was about Jimmy Floyd Hasselbank, mm-hmm, at Burton Albion, and he said that he's the soft one, his assistant is like the bulldog. Mm-hmm. And it might be that this new breed of managers are coming through, and especially guys who have worked like Stubbs with young players coming through Everton, he maybe has to have that side to him where he's got to manage the quite fragile type. And it might be that this first year of management has gone, I need to be a different type of manager with men than I do with like these 16, 17 year olds.
Well, professional squads are getting younger as well, yeah, in Scotland, because if you're good enough by 24, you're no here anymore.
Exactly.
So they are getting younger, and generally, speaking about, you know, football and culture, they tend to be less well adjusted as people as well.
Yeah,
they can't take, you know, the strips being torn off them in the same way. Toys go out the pram and they go, and they don't necessarily take it in the right way. You know, where in the 80s players would have gone away and knuckled down and come back, proved the manager wrong. Now they maybe just go out in the lash with their mates on a Saturday night, and mm-hmm, that's the opposite of what you want. So it is a difficult dynamic to manage, but I do think there is, Connor touched on it, that thing of, for a while you're willing to give the manager the benefit of the doubt when he so steadfastly sticks up for his players at all times, that you say, well, he will be tearing strips off them in the dressing room, it's just he's not going to do that in public. But then, because you can't see it, and because he still won't ever say a word, you get to the point where if results don't go your way, you start to doubt, well, is he actually, or is he just a soft touch?
Well, it kind of goes hand in hand with his, you know, the main criticism of Stubbs is his refusal to change things, mm-hmm, and the lack of substitutions and thing, and that kind of goes hand in hand with his sort of belief in his players as infallible. You know, you get the feeling that he's watching a different game from you. When you're like, when you're watching, you're saying, this isn't working, you feel like he's, you know, he's almost talking himself into saying, oh, it's going to work out.
So, well, I'd say on that is, obviously he's shown a lot of confidence in the run up to the game. I think he does believe in the players, but also we've kind of backed it up three times against Rangers. We've played them off the park particularly at Easter Road in the first time. So he's got sort of almost every right to be saying in public, like, my guys can handle this. It is a big occasion, but we've taken Rangers before and we can do it again. Obviously, it's kind of backfired on us on Wednesday night at least, and today there were times where it kind of looked like it would have been. But I've got no problem with Stubbs saying that he knows what the guys are capable of and they can do it. It might kind of come back in his face, but I think personally that's something I'm okay with, because we've got a manager, like I say, who believes in the players and he wants them doing things the right way, as opposed to what we've had, particularly the last 6 months of last season, where it was just scaring the players into trying to do something. And like Michael said, you know, he's been a youth coach, so he knows how to nurture young guys, and we do have a young side, and he's clearly been doing that. And also he's having to do it with somebody like Scott Allen, who's maybe a bit of a maverick and needs a bit of attention as well, just to make him more of a team player as opposed to individual than he might have been at certain times. But yeah, Stubbs and his kind of interviews, I'm happy to see him do that. It's a different side to a Hibs manager, someone who's talking clearly of what they believe in the players, rather than, you know, oh well, hopefully we can do this and hopefully we can get a result. Got a manager saying, like, we will get this result, we will do this.
There's probably an element of him to try and manage some fractured characters for last season as well. Obviously, he still inherited quite a bit of last season's players, and he's probably had to his first probably mentality has had to adopt his the kind of the big brother sort of role, to get these guys believing in him. He's maybe just not been able in the space of one season to transition out of that relationship that he had to kind of build. And it might be that next season we've got a lot of these guys out of contract who everyone's assuming are going to get contracts, that may not, like, you know, something like Lewis Stevenson. He might not be required next season, if we want to kind of start playing in a different fashion.
That's what I said at the game. I think that this summer will be a good buy for Lewis.
Now I'm depressed.
Let's wrap up on Alan Stubbs there then. Let's touch one general point that I want to raise about the game, and then we'll start to get on to personnel, both in terms of the last two games against Rangers, and then I think that'll lead us on to a discussion of the summer as well. The general point: have we, and I think the rest of the media possibly as well, been a wee bit naive in terms of looking in the build-up to this game at Hibs versus Rangers over the season, and using the basis that Hibs dominated the game three times and it was a very straightforward win, but taking an eye off the ball that was Ali McCoist's Rangers, and that was a massive... But that had a massive part to play in the way that those games played out. Has Stuart McCall made a much bigger difference than we possibly gave him credit for?
Yeah, I was going to say that that's one of maybe another mistake that Stubbs has made, is that he hasn't acknowledged that Stuart McCall's Rangers are a very different proposition from the team we played earlier in the season. And I know it's mostly the same players, although he's changed up a little with some of the players that were out of favour. But Stuart McCall seems to have turned them into a very blunt but quite effective instrument in the bigger games. They're still not the finished article by any means, and who knows how they're going to get on against Motherwell. But you got to remember that McCall had a good 6 months out of the game where he was watching Rangers play every week, and probably watching Hibs quite a lot as well. And he's not a stupid man. He probably could foresee this eventuality of a head to head in the playoffs between Hibs and Rangers, and I think he may well have planned, you know, he may well plan for this circumstance? Sequence of events, that's what I'm trying to say. Sorry, the words aren't quite coming to me.
1.7% cider.
That's it, no, because I've started slavering. Well, I've continued slavering. But that's, you know, and as I think McCall, as unfortunately to say, he's, and tactically and in terms of mind games, I think he's played it quite well. But even coming out the other night and saying that they didn't really deserve their 2-0 victory, mm-hmm. I think he was being a little disingenuous there. I think he could foresee that this game, I think he probably planned for it to be a 0-0, the last minute goal, you know. Is it a consolation? I'm not sure. But I think that McCall has had one over Stubbs, and that's three games in a row now where he's had a bit more tactical foresight.
Nothing to disagree on there. Like, up until the start of this season, I think Stuart will call, but regarded as one of the best managers in the country, consistently taking a Motherwell side, with entirely different personnel every year, to second place, having to rebuild teams. So I don't think there was any shock that he probably knew, given that he'd spent a great deal of the last two or three seasons getting the better of Hibs repeatedly as well, that he, taking on a group of Rangers players, could still get the same job done. So I think that, I don't think anyone on Wednesday assumed that Hibs were going to go and get another 2 or 3-0 victory. I think that would have been immensely ambitious against a very different kind of Rangers squad. But I think there's probably an element of shock that we lost 2-0 and didn't really look like scoring a great deal at Ibrox. And I think that probably shocked people in terms of the impact it had on today's match. Mm-hmm. They probably weren't quite at that time matching up the consequences of how Saturday might look based on Wednesday. So I think that there was an element of underestimating Rangers, not overestimating Hibs, but underestimating Rangers and how they have come on since McCall went in, and what they've become as a unit, if you like.
Taking it on just for one random question before we get into the nitty gritty of the players, has the change in dynamic between these two clubs from the three extremely straightforward victories for Hibs to three performances that ultimately, obviously, Rangers lost today, but it did what they needed to do. Does that actually emphasise that the general wisdom, I think, barring the odd obvious example of a manager who completely builds a team in his own image, the general wisdom in football tends to be it's all about the players. Whoever's got the best players will ultimately win the game. And there's been at various points where there seem to be a bit of a cult of the manager, and that's been built up. But have these games actually shown that the manager is perhaps more vitally important than he's even given credit for? That one man coming in can just completely change the dynamic.
Absolutely, in the last three matches, you've seen it. The three games we beat Rangers, they were all over the place. And McCall's come in and he's just organised them. It's the same group of players, a poor group of players. They're not anyway, shape or form better than us. All that McCall's done is just, he's organised them better and he's got the senior guys on his side so they can properly do their own job and then give their instructions to sort of younger guys like Murdoch. So, yeah, McCall's just, he's showed that he is a good manager. He's got organisation and that's all he's had to really do since he took the job.
Mm-hmm. It's also been, it's coming kind of hand in hand at the same time as like the kind of, the madness at Ibrox is relatively calmed down at the same time as well, and they've been able to focus probably just primarily on the football. McCall's now had to be doing what Alan McCoist was doing and Kenny McDullough was doing, and like counterbalancing their sort of press conferences and everything about the club was about the boardroom as much as the team. McCall's probably coming in just going, I don't need to worry about anything to do with that. Like, he came in after January, so there was nothing he could do on signings. He had what he had. At this point, like, you know, King and all these guys looked like they were going to get the club, so it was just about the football team. I think that's definitely played into their hands as well.
Connor, has that put Alan Stubbs at a disadvantage going into these couple of games because he has so little evidence to go on of what this new Rangers are, whereas because of Hibs' limited squad, because of the injury situation, Stubbs essentially had McCall had a season's worth of, you know, research to go, games that he could go back and watch and pretty much see exactly how Hibs were going to approach the game.
I think so. I think, you know, we were particularly unlucky in the last game of the season to lose both Boyle and Foster because they were two players who could have brought something a little unusual, because although Foster's an effective defender, he's actually one of our main aerial threats in terms of scoring from headers and set pieces and whatnot, and then Boyle is, you know, again something completely different. So we've had a bit of bad luck there, but I would have said in terms of what you were saying about management over talent, McCall's first Rangers game at Easter Road, where we lost their back three of Zaliukas and McCulloch and Moshne, you know, there was a bit of hubris from Hibs fans in that match because we're like, oh, look at this, we're going to look at this static back three, we're going to absolutely overrun them today, you know. And then after the game, there's a bit of anger, like, look at that back three, how did we lose to this team? But this is the thing of McCall, you know, using this quite limited apparatus effectively, and this is what's happened over the last three matches. I think he understands that it's not the best team he's ever gonna manage, but he's used them to the, and even the likes of Dean Shields, you know, he wasn't playing at all, and he's probably, you know, you wouldn't really describe him as a top six player, really. You know, he's probably you know, a bit of a journeyman player, but he's been used to good effect over the sort of latter part of the season. So this is where again Stubbs' sort of lack of experience comes into play, because we kind of have these two shapes that we play, these two formations, and out with that, he doesn't seem to have like a plan whereby, you know, he can effectively make the most of players despite their deficiencies. If a player has certain flaws in his game, it seems to be something that we tolerate rather than, you know, maximise the potential for. Mm-hmm.
Any final points on the managers before we move on to the players specifically?
I think I would touch on is that, obviously we talked about, like Connor just mentioned, the two main ways that we've been able to play. I think that it'd be worth questioning Stubbs on how he made the choice to essentially relinquish the wingers that we had on the books in January. As much as like it didn't seem to be working for us at that point.
He really put all his eggs
it made it very, very clear to opposition that this is how we're going to play the rest of the season. And having that, a game like today, it'd be Kennedy or somebody else, but a game like today, after an hour, if you'd put Kennedy on the park, he would have tore Foster to pieces.
Yeah.
And been putting balls into El Alagu, who loves a guy, a wee winger playing, you know, for him. So I think that the risk of almost exchanging Harris for Boyle, which took a few months to bear fruit, as well as not having any other option to play wide, further up the park rather than just the wing backs, certainly gave other managers a kind of viewpoint of going, well, they don't have that type of game changer. If they change the game, it's not going to be in that fashion. And we were quite limited as to how we could change up the 3-5-2 or the 4-4-2. It wasn't going to be a 4-4-2 flat with a wide player. It had to be that diamond shape, and if it did change, you're putting guys out of position. And we've done that in one game when McGeoch got caught out for the goal at Hampden, playing him wide right. It's like having the right players and the right personnel to do different things is going to be massive going into next season. It'll be really interesting to see what Stubbs does. Like, absolutely, Kevin, I think next season we're going to see Hibs playing a 4-3-3 that he tried at the start of the season but clearly didn't have the right guys to do it. I think Hibs will play that way next season, and that kind of quite popular current 4-3-3 formation, basically wide guys cutting inside. But I think that would be something Stubbs has to look at as well going into the season, is how he builds his squad and like maintains it throughout the season.
I think you're specifically right about Matt Kennedy there, because you would struggle to find a Hibs fan that had a bad word to say about him during his loan spell. If we kept him on, you know, he did play well in the games, and when he left, people were saying, oh well, you know, he just didn't fit into the shape of the squad or the ethos that the Stubbs wants to have for playing. But he would have been perfect today. Maybe not so much Alex Harris. I think that loan deal's worked out quite well with Martin Boyle, but Matt Kennedy particularly, you know, hindsight is a great thing, because at the time a lot of people were like, oh well, you know, good player, but it's a shame.
Yeah, nobody in January thought, oh, I can't believe he's leaving.
Yeah,
I wonder if Stubbs' hands were just tied in that scenario, in that he had come to Hibs to play and he wasn't playing. Mm-hmm. So ultimately when Stubbs went back to Everton with the report card, he couldn't really justify the idea that it's worth leaving him on loan here for an extra 4 months, because he ultimately wasn't playing.
Yeah.
And then he's actually no going back there. I think they've
been to Cardiff and played pretty much every week.
Yeah, he's done really well.
On. So it is that thing of, I think, because he found the four diamond two and that worked, and then he stuck so steadfastly to it. Even had he wanted to keep Kennedy, I think it would have been a hard sell to say, well, he'll be our 12th man. Well, that's not really why we loaned him to a Scottish Championship club.
He wasn't signed to be in Everton's eyes like a game changer for us when things are going right.
Okay, any final points?
No.
Okay, we'll go to some adverts right now then, and we will be back in 2 minutes on Monday Night Football. We're back on Monday Night Football. Let's move on to the pressing matters of the players who have been involved over the last couple of games, and then looking forward to who we think will be retained, who will choose to stay, and what priorities Alan Stubbs is likely to have over the summer months in terms of where he strengthens and who he brings in. I want to start, Craig brought up a point with Scott Allen that at times he maybe either looks to do too many things himself or gets drawn into doing things on behalf of the team that actually you'd rather not have him doing, you'd rather have him doing other things. We've heard a lot of the bottlers discussion over the last couple of weeks, and I think it's over-egged, but from an outsider's perspective, there are quite a few bodies in the Hibs team who seem possibly a wee bit willing to defer to others in terms of doing certain jobs, and that a lot of times Scott Allen picks the ball up, and the reason that in games like today I think he's no got the end product is that a lot of people in the Hibs team kind of stop making runs that they would for other players because they kind of just expect him to be able to play a goal scoring goal. But who's he going to pass to if you've all stopped your run? It's the Steven Gerrard Jordan Henderson thing, that Jordan Henderson is an exponentially poorer player next to Steven Gerrard, because rather than, you know, getting on the ball and forcing the tempo, he looks at Steven and says, well, that's your job. I think there are a few players in the Hibs team who, you know, saying they're a fragile character or anything like that is over-egging it, but saying that they maybe wait for someone else to do something when they could just do it themselves, maybe isn't it? I think El Alagui, we saw that when he came on as well, that he took it with a scuff of the neck and wanted to do it. Is that a mentality issue that still exists amongst too many of the Hibs players?
I think so, yeah. I think, you know, another perfect example is the semi-final with Falkirk. I watched that back, and that was happening throughout the game. I mean, unfortunately, Alagui was having a bit of a bad time of it. I don't think he was fully fit. I think he'd maybe done his panning in the derby the week before. But if you rewatch that game, Scott Allen was doing almost everything on the park. And we were very much a sort of one-man team throughout that game. And as such, he does get a lot of criticism because it's like, oh, he's always doing that disguise pass, or he's always trying to do everything. But I do think that certain players on the park are encouraging him to play in that fashion. You know, he does have that slight ego to him where he wants to be the man that the rest of the team's revolving around. And, you know, it becomes a bit of a cycle where players are happy to give him the ball and then let him sort of run wild. And, you know, he needs a bit more support whether he likes it or not.
Anyone got something to add on that?
I think it's pretty clear that it's, in terms of intelligence wise, that Scott Allen's a level above the rest of the team in terms of what, like I was saying, the sort of reverse passes that he wants to play. He gets frustrated that the other players aren't on the same wavelength as what he is. And it's like I use the term about Jason Cummins. Like, Jason Cummins is probably the polar opposite to what Allen is in terms of intelligence, because in the 18 yard box, Jason Cummins, that's where Cummins is at his best. You know, he can anticipate balls coming in. But if it's outside the box in terms of general play, like, I can see what Jason Cummins is going to do before he's even started to do it. Whereas Scott Allen just has a completely different, like, I know it's going a bit far, but saying like on the Paul Scholes type level, but he is the sort of Paul Scholes that we've got in terms of, you know, he's the one who can dictate the way that the game goes. But unlike Scholes, who had all these class players around him, Allen doesn't have anyone near him that's on the same sort of wavelength.
It reminds me of when Darren Jackson played for Hibs. There's a phrase that gets used a lot now, like, Darren Jackson saw pictures that nobody else in the Hibs team ever did. He used to get criticised for playing balls and there's nobody there. Should have been. Like, there really should have been, like, people there. And I think Allen is that similar type of player where he's surrounded by inferior players and he sees pictures, but there's other people just nowhere near on the same wavelength. And we're not talking about, like, you know, doing like crazy, crazy things, but, you know, we've had a guy for years who plays ball like in between the centre half and the fullback, and now we've got him this season, and it's taken a while for us to take advantage of it. But there's still, I think, a lack of tactical intelligence among certain players in the team.
That interests
or risk taking amongst them. Like, he is the only risk taker in our team, and it might be that Stubbs is like over. It's not a word. Tacticalised the team, where like they want to perform their role and their function. And it seems like Scott Allen's the one guy who is allowed complete freedom on how he carries out his function within the team, and the rest of them seem to stick through the same area of the park or the same run repeatedly, and don't play enough on instinct. I think Cummins is the only guy for me who's an instinctive player. The rest of them seem quite regimented in the way that they play, and I think that we need possibly more, not maverick footballers, but guys who think off the cuff a bit more in their movement and like where they find themselves on the pitch, to get the best out of a Scott Allen or a similar type of player.
That interests me though, because again, I think there's maybe an element of Hibs getting a wee bit too caught up in convention there, and that they're looking at it and they're thinking Scott Allen's our best player, arguably head and shoulders our best player, let's get him the ball as often as possible, when in actual fact, so people defer to him, but actually it would be better if Hibs were a very workmanlike team with 10 guys who are less capable of playing that, you know, kind of top standard of football that Scott Allen can, and Scott Allen just appeared at random points as an X factor to play that ball that no one else can see, but you know, that maybe actually opens the defence, whereas he's actually, I wonder if he's overexposed. That's why we're saying, oh, that's the 10th time he's tried that reverse pass, because he's had the ball 10 times more than anyone else. If everyone else takes their, you know, shoulders their element of the responsibility, then Allen is involved less and his impact means more, rather than having him 50 yards out for goal pulling the strings there. And let McGeoch do that, get elsewhere, so that when you appear it's to make the telling contribution and to create the goal, rather than try to do it all the time. That's where my issue comes in. I wish guys would do the neat and tidy stuff and just let him get involved to create.
The last time I heard an Allen type player was Russell Latapy, and the players around Latapy were happy to take on the responsibility of either making themselves available for him, or like John O'Neill was a perfect example. He did the donkey work that let Latapy play.
Whereas if you think like McGeoch and Fivey and Robertson to an extent, aren't they a John O'Neill type?
Aye, they're all quite technically, like, not so much Robertson, but like Fivey and McGeoch are technically talented enough where they may think that they can also be a playmaker.
But you want those characters as well, the guys who'll say, what are you doing here? Mm-hmm. You know, it's a free kick and we're 20 yards inside our own half. Why are you taking it? Mm-hmm. Get out there we can get the body and you can hurt
anyone
someone.
Anyone can float that ball into the box, and he needs to kind of start thinking, like, I can be more effective elsewhere.
But and that's where I wonder if the whole shrinking violet mentality that outsiders look at Hibs and think that a good football team where the chips are down, ultimately they'll all go into their shell. And I think it's wee things like that, more so than this big idea of bottling the big games. Mm. It's those wee things that start to combine and make that happen, that there's a couple of big characters and everyone else just lets them get on with it, rather than standing up for themselves and saying, let me do this, you go and do what you're good at. Okay, let's go through the actual players then. We'll just do it through the 11 and we can throw in the subs and stuff when they come in. We'll talk a wee bit about how they fared over the couple of games, a wee bit about how they fared over the season, and then whether we think they've any part to play in Hibs' future. Some of these will be 10-second conversations, some of them could be hour-long conversations. We'll try and keep them as snappy as we can. Mark Oxley, thoughts?
See you later.
Yeah, decent championship player, but it's not, you know... I mean, aside from anything else, he's still on loan. There's not much.
To me, he's not been, been by no means a problem this season. He's not the reason we didn't win the league, obviously, and he's not the reason we didn't win this playoff match. But thank you very much. We can move on and find somebody as adequate or potentially better. There might be that guy sitting on the bench just now. We'll see over the summertime if it's Cherney or not. But I don't think that we can sort of say that our season has been dictated by anything that happened to the goalkeeper. Hallelujah, when was the last time we could say that?
Any thoughts on why we've no seen any of Tierney?
Maybe it's still just comfortable with Oxley.
Did he have mumps or something, or he's not ill?
He was out for a while with mumps, but even then he's still not. You would have expected like the tail end of the season for him to maybe get a run out, because I don't even think he's been playing that much for the 20s
either. The end of the season, we still had everything to play for though, and I don't think you just throw him into like a match where we had like a lot of riding on it. Like until the last day of the season, we weren't in second place. So I think that...
But I mean, in terms of the games against like someone against like Cowdenbeath, or, you know, teams that haven't posed us problems this season, like a Cowdenbeath or a Livingston or something, just give them a game in there just to let them, you know, so he feels... Because I don't feel... We'll go on to the rest of the team, but I don't feel you know, you say Stubbs believes in his players, but I think he only believes in a select, maybe 13 out of the full squad. We've not seen Stanton for weeks, apart from Falkirk. We've not seen Hand. When was the last time Danny Handling got a game? I'm by no means his biggest fan, but he's still...
On the flip side, those guys just listed have had opportunities during the season and did nothing to justify being given further game times. Like, when you're, like, he's not throwing Stanton in against Rangers and Hearts, he's thrown him in against Cowden Beath and Dumbarton, and he's not really done enough to justify going, well, McGeoch's sitting out for you or Allen's sitting out
and
for
I
you.
And I think that might be a point that we come back to with a lot of guys, where it's kind of nice to have, but no necessarily someone that you would mourn if they were lost. Oxley, I think, is arguably the perfect example of that. Come in, done exactly what you were signed for, but there will be no clamouring to pay any sort of money to keep
him. Hopefully Cherney, only within the club will they know if there's a specific reason that Cherney never played. Mm-hmm. It might be they signed an agreement going, I'm number two for the rest of the season, then I'm going to be number one.
I think Thomas Cherney was specifically signed because Oxley did get injured sort of in the second quarter of the season.
And you're looking
and
at playing
Pentro.
You're playing either a teenager or Alan.
Well, there was a couple of those panics even very early in the season. We were talking, when we had Graham Stack on, we were talking about, are you free for the derby? Because there was no keepers.
So I think Stubbs maybe was really... Just if Oxley's fine, if he does get injured, we need a suitable replacement. We can't put a teenager on the pitch, say we're playing Hearts.
Analysis of Mark Oxley isn't going to come to a solution whereby our season could have been massively better or worse by him playing less.
So do we expect, looking at the summer then, for Stubbs to be looking for a first choice keeper who's the replacement for Oxley, or are we looking at Cherney stepping up and someone coming in to challenge him?
I'd be happy to see Cherney step
up. It's entirely dependent on what version of Cherney has come back to Scotland after a few seasons away. None of us know.
Find that out until he plays? I think it's an odd position, goalkeeper, in that you
can
can't
tell
really
so much
see
by
how
training,
they dictate
but you can
the game,
because
so much is about how they organise the back four and interact with the guys in front of them. Mm. That it'll be. I think it might pose a wee bit of a conundrum for Stubbs in terms of what he does go for.
The other thing with Oxley, and with Cherney not playing in terms of Oxley, it might be that it damages Stubbs' reputation amongst Premier League clubs, taking their players on loan. If he had to give up Kennedy because they didn't play him enough, did they also then drop another on loan Premier League player, and then Premier League clubs, they're not taking our players?
That's a very interesting point.
Sinclair was there for the first few weeks, and then he was just...
So those guys who hardly played, I think he made the right call and going, right, they can go away, but then do you lose a goalkeeper during the season when the defence got used to playing with them, and Premier League clubs going to go, now you're not getting our players, other than Everton, obviously, you give them all the players under the sun.
Well, that's something that I want to bring up, because I think it influences the conversation when we're talking about what needs to happen over the summer. Hibs have had a culture over the last few years where they've been more than willing to take players on loan to solve problems within their own squad. And at times that then has come in for direct criticism, thinking in particular about May 2012, where it then became a stick to beat the team with. That it wasn't that they weren't good enough, it wasn't that there's a problem in terms of talent, it was that they all didn't bother because they were on loan. The Hibs need to move away from that and use a loan, to use an example from the other side of the city. Zayfout came in on loan because Hearts had one specific problem and he was there as a solution to it. Hibs sometimes have had teams that have lined up with 3, 4, 5 players on loan.
Look at the cup final.
Yeah, even in terms of investment from the fans, it's far better if you feel like a player's long-term committed to the cause rather than only being here for 3 or 4 months to further his own career. Is that something that Hibs need to change in next season, try and limit the amount of loans they have? I know they've not got too many at the moment, but you are still looking at...
I think the ones that came in this season have, in the majority, played. And I don't think we could point any fingers at their commitment to the cause. You know, something like McGeoch, Oxley... obviously Watson's come in and been a bit more peripheral, but he provided depth where we needed it. Guys like that, I don't think we can. I think Stubbs has done it differently this season, in that the guys that he's brought in, I think he's done it with the intention of them being first team players rather than filling out the squad. I'm sure he would have hoped that Kennedy worked out as a permanent first team fixture. The Sinclair one, who knows what the idea was behind that. Maybe there was something there about him that hasn't quite come out, but I think Stubbs has adopted a very different approach to loan signings than his predecessors did, where he's brought guys in to play and improved the team. So as long as he does the same thing and we still have a core of signed players who have, even in the circumstances of Oxley and McGeer, that they're both coming out of contract at their clubs. Mm-hmm. So again, they've got a short window to put themselves in, so they still had that the intrinsic motivation to play really well, rather than if you sign a guy who's 6 months into a 3-year deal at a club, he may not have that great, you know, a great deal to prove, because he probably still knows he's 18 months away from being in that first team squad. So if he continues to pick the right type of loan signings, I don't have an issue with it, because it's not as much of a scattergun approach as it was under Pat Fenlon. Even like Boyle's come in and being effective, and seems to want to stay at the club, so I certainly, if he adopts that approach where it's guys who improve the first team, then I'm perfectly fine with it.
You'd imagine that next year there probably won't be as much reliance on loans as well, just because Stubbs has got a bit more time. There was an element of panicking, quick, we need to get something together.
And even if it is short notice, more loans, it'll be more thought out loan signings that he's probably been talking about with them with the clubs for the last 2 or 3 months, when we'd like to take him next season for the whole season, because he's going to perform this function in the team that I've got planned in my head. Again, like Connor says, so he can have that plan time.
Yeah, the swap deals, I think specifically, have worked quite well. Like with the Boyle and Hart swap deal seems to have benefited all parties. So you'd imagine, rather than just the scattergun approach, there's going to be a bit more thought put in into the loan deals this year, and probably quite a few less loans.
I think even next season it'd be a case like really we're trying to build a squad for 1 year, because also the expectation is next year we get out of the Championship, and you can't really do constant loan signings in the Premiership because it's not building anything. It's just, like I say, it's a short term problem you're taking care of. So yeah, I think there will be more loan signings for next season, but again, it's not, I don't think it'll be the long term strategy. It'll be after that, a good core of players in, and again, there might be one or two guys who can come and go, but really that spine of the team, it's got to be the same next year, and if we're in the Premiership the following season, it's got to be the same there as well, just to kind of build the momentum on.
Okay, let's move through the rest of the team then. Just a few comments, if there are any, make about the performance over the last couple of games, and then we'll discuss them going forward. David Gray's a bit unique one, because I didn't think it's really fair to analyse him over the last two games. He's been thrown in there because there's no other option with injuries, and ultimately he's back from injury, arguably. You know, he could have been rushed for all we know. Certainly, he didn't appear to adjust as quickly to a return to first team football this time as he has before. Generally, though, I think a roaring success of a free transfer.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, obviously, the games he's come back recently, he was obviously kept like wrapped up in cotton wool to come back to these playoff matches, playing against probably the best opponent in the league as well, in Lee Wallace. So I think he certainly played better today than he did on Wednesday. Again, didn't by any means have a poor game on Wednesday, it just wasn't as influential. That first half hour today, he was much more influential. He was always outside, high up the park. I don't think he comes in for really any great deal of criticism for what he contributed over the two matches.
Is he a guy that we expect to see being given more responsibility going forward? Obviously, we've seen club captain Liam Craig actually operate on the outskirts of the squad. Mm-hmm. Are we expecting David Gray to be full-time captain next season?
I would expect so.
Unless somebody's brought into the club who is an absolute standout captain figure, has a reputation, a history of being a club captain, then yeah, I don't see why not. Maybe Liam Fontaine if he stays on, but that's quite doubtful. I don't think anyone would have an issue with David Gray being a club captain.
I think today, you know, as we spoke about earlier, that slight period of chaos, sort of 10 minutes in the second half where the formation changed, I think Fontaine and Gray between them take a lot of the credit for sorting things out between themselves. If there has been a little bit of naivety or sort of lack of communication from Stubbs, you get the feeling that those two have sort of taken a hand of things and taken control.
Okay, let's pause on Fontaine for a second and let's deal with the other right backs in the scenario. Keith Watson is currently on loan, but I believe his deal's coming to an end at Dundee United as well. Would anyone expect to see him line up in green next year?
No, we can do better. I think
probably not.
I think for what he'd probably expect in terms of salary and whatnot, like, I don't think he's shown to be good enough to be a first pick. I doubt he'd sign for us as a second pick in any position. He's not quick enough to be a good wing back, and he's not naturally, I think, a centre half. So I don't think that he's somebody we're desperate to keep, and he probably would be expecting a certain salary as an SPL player.
And conversely, I think Dundee United probably want him back as
well.
He's not getting a new contract. Yeah. So.
Oh, okay, I thought.
I always thought the point of him coming on loan was to give him some, because I thought the intention was that he wanted to go down to England.
Mm-hmm. It did seem like it was somewhere up a shop window, because he had been phased out at Dundee United. Yeah. Because they signed Ryan McGowan essentially as his replacement while he was still there. Okay, Martin Boyle signed as a striker, moved to right wing, and now he's in the right back conversation. So he's had a rather strange 5 months at Hibernian. What are the thoughts on Boyle generally?
I'd keep him, definitely.
If it's possible, I would keep him.
Like you just mentioned, he can perform different functions in the team.
Mm-hmm. He would have gave us that plan B. Today, you know, just because he's got pace and he can get at people, and he would have given Gray a lot more cover as well. Because if Boyle was fit, you could even have an argument to Gray goes into the three with Handler and Fontaine, and that gives us the option to play.
Yeah, I think Boyle was your option to start the game.
You're three at the back. If we play Gray in a three with Boyle outside him. You know, if when we're going forward, it then can sort of transition into that back four. Mm-hmm. You know, we just your right back going out of position, as long as Stevenson stays back and covers, and then you've got Wallace up against Gray and Boyle, mm-hmm. whereas Wallace only has, and you know, he's not fully fit, so Gray's not got the pace to go past Wallace.
Facing both of them, he's got one of them at 75%.
Exactly.
I think the thing with Boyle as well is, if we've got him for a year in the Championship, it could be that, even though he's got rough edges, maybe in a year at that level might allow him to be sort of polished up a bit in an Ivan Sproul type style, where we can coach a bit more football intelligence into him.
And that lets him sort of go into the 4-3-3. Yeah. If you expect him to go 4-3-3 next season, he's the ideal.
He can potentially be that bit of a weapon if we got promoted next season, going into the SPL. If we spent a year really working hard on his kind of understanding of the game and like working on his finishing and things like that, I think he could be quite an asset going into the SPL, hopefully in a year's time.
This is a random, irrelevant question, but the answer interests me, so I'm going to ask it anyway. Would we be having the same conversation about Boyle had Hibs won the day? Had Hibs turned the tie round and potentially been going at the SPL? Would he, do we believe that he also would have formed part of a Hibs squad in the Premier League?
Possibly.
I think so. I think he definitely ingratiated himself with the fans over the last few games that he played.
Because he's not been playing as a striker as well, he's been playing out wide, which is something we've struggled with all season. They say we've got any wingers at the club right now. So as a winger, you can say, he's got a place in the team. As a striker, it's really debatable, because we've already had four on today, and then you put Boyle in, that's five strikers that we've got, and really only two of them start, and one maybe changes that.
The SPL is also quite a limited league, that I think a guy with serum pace can still be, with maybe not as much technical ability, can still be a real asset.
Exactly what Sproul was.
Teams about a season and a half to understand how to play Ivan Sproul. So I think that a guy like him still would have been an asset. Perhaps you'd think about his role in the team being right, so maybe he isn't going to be a first pick in whichever formation Stubbs would go ahead with. But I think in the Championship next season, he would certainly be a highly useful player to have in the squad, and at times, as he's shown in the last couple of months, a starter in particular circumstances. So I think he would have been a yes still, but a different type of yes.
Okay, I'm going to try and batter through the next three, because I think there's then an interesting one coming up. Fontaine, Hanlon, Forster, everyone's satisfied with their contribution, happy to see them as the three main centre halves?
I'd be happy to see Hanlon go.
I think Hanlon's,
as much as he's improved this season, I think it's time to, I think for both parties, it's maybe time for a wee change.
Could it not maybe be said that the best time would be next season after a successful season?
No, I'd rather see he plays, if he's going to play in a back two with Fontaine, providing Fontaine stays, I would much rather see Forster as the other centre-half with Fontaine, rather than
the only reason
playing a left footer in that right-sided defensive role. I would much rather see Forster get a chance to cement his position. You know, Hanlon's mm-hmm. had now seven, eight seasons, and this is the season where he's finally settled in.
Which it can be argued is because he's found his level in the championship.
Possibly. The reason that I would keep him is that I don't think Fontaine's going to stay. I think that it'd be better to retain some stability and continuity.
So you would think...
I don't think Fontaine will stay, so
I'd
keep
him. If Fontaine goes, mm-hmm. you've then got Handler and Forster as your main centre-halves.
Unless he finds another first-pick centre-half and he wants to do something different.
Do you think he'll be in the market for a first-pick centre-half?
I think he will.
Quite probably.
Even if Fontaine stays, or if Fontaine stays, then it's a younger backup team, maybe.
Somebody who can play a couple of positions, possibly. If Fontaine stays, Hanley would only go if we got offered a fee for him, I think. I don't think there's any sort of, I think, need to release him, if you like, and offer him on a free transfer. Even today, I thought he was outstanding. Like, I thought he had a tremendous game.
But I thought he was poor on Wednesday. I thought he was very, very poor on Wednesday. I thought Miller and Clark ran him ragged at times. I think that he's not. It's nothing personal against him. I just think it's time for a change. Maybe he needs a change just as much as Hibs do.
I think if
Fontaine goes, then you've still got Hanlon and Forster are the back two of the team that got relegated. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean? There's still that, you know, when folks say there's still that sort of harping back to, you know, the older sort of mentality. You know, Forster and Hanlon played at the back.
We still had a tremendous defensive record. We couldn't score for Toffee though. We didn't have a bad defence when we got relegated. We couldn't score for weeks.
It's still been that they're still. Yeah, I would still associate mm-hmm. them with the team that went down. Whereas with this season, you know, Liam Craig's more than likely going to leave. Mm-hmm. So that's another one down. Harris is pretty much out the door. So then you've only really got Forster and Hanlon and Stevenson that are left. You know, granted, Stevenson never actually played that much under Butcher, and if he did, he was on the complete opposite side to what he should be. Mm. But I just think it's, you know, if it's taken us this long to find Hanlon's level, if we got offered money for him from a championship club or even a lower level SPL club, I would snatch it.
So crazy. I think suggesting a bit more of a ruthless approach from our side. Like, in terms of, you know, fans like Stevenson and Hanlon, I'm sure we're going to talk about Lewis Stevenson next, but like you're suggesting that it's time, no matter, even if they've been good players, you know, thanks for your service,
but you know what, we're going in a completely different direction.
That's what I think we'll round up on at the end, is what we'll try and do is that of the points that we've made, we'll try and list them in priority, because it's easy to just rip it up and start again, but at the end you maybe need to factor in, well, yeah, we would do this, but that's 10th on the list compared to everything else.
Handling, he's been really unfortunate at the time he's been here. He's had some really questionable defensive partners. I mean, last season, for a time, it was Michael Nelson. No young player should be put next to Michael Nelson.
Nobody should be put next to Michael Nelson.
An old school bruiser with like no ability, could barely jump, you know, off a Rizzler paper, and you expect Handling to learn off this guy. Really not ideal. You've got Fontaine, who's same big guy, but technically really good defender. Mm-hmm. Seen it all season, he's comfortable taking the ball, and Hanlon, I think, because that is a lot more comfortable, he knows that, you know, he isn't the sort of the main defender for once. He can sit there, and there's a guy there who knows exactly what he's doing. Hanlon can do his own job without that kind of worry in the back of his mind, and I think you can maybe pass that on now to Forster, and the two of them, they've both also still got flaws and still a bit ropey at times, but I think Forster's looked solid for the last few games that he's played, and Hanlon has had a really good season. I think it's a good time now to just implement the two as, like, right, first choices, but there's still another guy in the wing there that can come in if need be.
It's a good point, and it's one that I may be criticised for making given my allegiances, but we do often talk about players owning clubs and, you know, then about the club being able to be ruthless in a way of saying thanks for your service but no thanks, because if a player does that, you know, it seems like they've turned their back on them. And but that is a good point, in that there are some of these players where you look at it and you think, in actual fact, they've maybe not reached the levels that, I think Paul Hanlon, you can easily say he's not reached the level that a lot of people thought he would.
One of the most capped under 21 players for Scotland,
but Hibs have probably hindered that progress more than they've helped it at times.
Absolutely.
And the Hibs have like we say, at times stitched him up with a defensive partner who he was never going to learn from, or if he learned from them, it was bad habits.
I think it's not even that. Like, for a number of seasons, he's had almost certainly a really questionable left back on this side, mm-hmm. and a really questionable centre half on that side, and a bunch of passengers standing in front of him.
And a manager who either didn't have the respect to the fans, didn't have the respect to the other players in the dressing room, or was just having a bit of laugh, you know, last season.
Exactly. I don't think you can question his defensive partners, because if you go through the players that we've had, you know, he would have learned off of somebody like Rob Jones when he was younger.
He was,
you know, being
like a teenager when Rob Jones was there.
But still, that's the funny thing with Hanlon, is that he's in with the bricks at Easter Road. I mean, he's been there so long, and yet he's not really a central character that you go to in the team. I think Craig's got a fair point, but it's just whether that is a priority this summer.
If we had an answer, I wouldn't be bothered if Hanlon left.
And again, I think that's another thing.
I mean, it's a necessity. I'm not so passionate as Craig might be to go, like, see you later, like, goodbye. I think that, again, at championship level, with what he's probably earning salary-wise and how we can utilise that, like, his salary elsewhere, can we A, get, and B, do we need better than Paul Hanlon to get out the championship?
Again, I think that's another thing we might come back to, is that some of these conversations would be different if there was a visible youngster in the wings who looked like they were capable of just coming in, and yeah, they would be a wee bit rusty, or they would need to pick it up as they go. But in actual fact, for a club who have had the youth has been a major presence at Hibs over the years, this year there's been less of it. It seems like there are players who are getting a wee sniff of first team football, but it's on the proviso of you're still a year away. We're just giving you a wee taster of it now, so that you're closer in a year to 18 months. Mm. I don't think there's really there's no a view that there's many who are rattling at the manager's door to try and get into this team. On that, let's go. That one proved to be more contentious than I had expected.
I would just say as well, with Liam Fontaine, like, I think if we had to prioritise players who are not currently going to be here next season, for me, he'd be the one player. I think he's the best centre half mm-hmm. we've had in a number of seasons. And you're talking about guys with the character and personality. For me, he ticks every single box. Like, he is captain material as well as a really good defender.
Yeah.
So
he actually wouldn't be that bad a replacement for Danny Olsen. We might see an Edinburgh bidding war.
Behave yourself. But I think for me, guys who currently don't have a contract for next season, if you had to make me pick one, it'd be Liam Fontaine.
Okay.
That's my gamble on that.
Right. Lewis Stevenson. Discuss.
Craig's going to be ruthless again, isn't he?
If we can get better. I think as much as I love Lewis Stevenson, and as he's had a good season, I still think that his flaws are there for all to see. His final ball isn't the greatest. He has a tendency not to attack the byline when the opportunity presents itself. I think that if McGeoch and Fivey are away, I reckon. I don't think they'll stay. If Robertson goes, I would much rather see us get a left back in and play Stevenson in midfield.
I think he's been quite,
because he's got the engine to go back and, you know, he could be the Scott Robertson type to go back and forth,
I'm not sure he's maybe technically strong enough to play the type of football that Stubbs wants to play.
But for me, he could be the spoiler. He can be the one to.
I think you can find spoilers now who are still adept footballers, maybe more so than Stevenson. I don't think it'd be a problem keeping him as a midfield player, but he's taken seasons to show he's a midfielder.
Are we not then even more in the realm of retreading mistakes that have happened before, and that this season seems to be the first one where Stevenson's actually found an identity and been able to properly contribute to the team week in, week out, rather than, oh, he looks like a midfielder today. Aye, doesn't he next week?
That's as a wing back and a back three, no, as a left back and a back four, I reckon.
Well, I was going to say, it's like Stevenson, almost like Hanlon's been hindered, because Stevenson played in every position imaginable since he's been at Hibs. He's never had I think it's the first season he's been
consistent
in one position, that's it. And he's clearly shown that, yeah, he's done really well, and I don't see any reason why not to keep him on. But if he'd been at left back his entire career, then he might not even be here. We wouldn't say he's going to be on to better things, but we might not have stayed at Hibs.
Okay, so Craig, you would like to see Stevenson return to a midfield role, maybe even a wee bit more utility like he used to be.
I think he'd be the perfect foil for Scott Allan.
But you'd like to see a speciality, like a specialised left back come in to assume that role.
Someone with a bit of pace about them. Someone that if we could somehow find another David Murphy, someone like Murphy, I would be very happy to see Stevenson go into midfield. Because I think it's a while ago now, but he was man of the match in the cup final when we beat Kilmarnock, and he played central midfield. Do you know? And he was magnificent.
Surrounded by superb players, though. Mm-hmm. I think,
and that was about 8 years ago.
He needs to be like.
I don't think you. I'm maybe reading a bit too much.
I think he, at this stage now, for him to stay, it's going to be as a squad player. I wouldn't have him in the first 11.
The thing that justifies your point, I think, Craig, is the fact that no matter what, Hibs have to go and look for a left back. I think we can all agree
absolutely.
On that. That they can't operate with Lewis Stevenson as the only left back. Mm-hmm. And equally.
Well, there's Callum Crane, I think his name is, in the under 20s, is trying to push. I think he's, if there's one that's going to, out with, because we know about players like Scott Martin and Lewis Allan, if there's one that's going to push on the door for a. And challenge for a spot, I reckon it'll be Crane, because he's quite highly thought of by people that go to, the people were making a shout for him last season when we were struggling. Obviously he's never, I think he's maybe made the bench a couple of times, but I think that we need to, I wouldn't be unhappy with Stevenson at left back for next season, but I think that we can find better.
I think we need a first line left back, a first pick left back, with possibly Crane as a backup. And like I said, if Stevenson stayed, for me, it's covering numerous areas like he's done in the past. And then does that really benefit anyone going forward if he goes back to being a kind of sort of Jim will fix it type player? Not with the sort of Sabalet. We're going to have him in the dressing rooms given the other 16s are up down and stuff. But I think that if he stays, for me, it can't be as a first pick anymore. I think like on Wednesday he was exposed as not being a left back, and like my gut feeling is that we're not going to play 3-5-2 or anything like that next season. I think it's going to be a back four, and I don't think he's a left back.
It's
and
funny
what Brian McGivern's up to after the summer.
It's funny because I circle back slightly on the Fontaine discussion that we had, where genuinely, if you looked at it, you took all the allegiances and the baggage that would come out of the way, and you said Hearts are looking for a player to fill Danny Wilson's boots, Fontaine arguably would. I think you can have the same conversation with Hibs and Adam Eckersley in that position.
Aye.
That he's maybe not shown up that well in the derby, so you guys may not have the same opinion, but from a Hearts perspective, he was consistent week in, week out for 6 months where we absolutely needed him because Mick Hattie was injured. He's an experienced head, he knows what it takes to win the championship now, that you could actually argue if he wanted to stay in Edinburgh, it would be the perfect fit to cut. He's not on a mad wage, he could in theory come in, but it's sort of the baggage that comes with it. Move across the city, I think if Hibs could get that type, that would then free them up to then do what you want with Stevenson, but you've at least got someone challenging him as well for that situation. Mm-hmm. Okay, because there's no another left back to talk about. That's the situation we're in. There was Callum Booth for a wee while.
Scott Allan for half an hour.
But the idea of ever putting David Gray back there for a period of time is just daft. It just negates everything that he does brilliantly at right back. Right, let's move into the crowd of bodies in the midfield then, and I think to an extent you can package them all together. Scott Allan is the one that sticks out, where he's under contract still, so there's no reason for him to go. If an insane bid was to come in, then you'd have to size it up, as you said previously, Mikey.
What
was talking about
insane for Scott Allan though? Like, what would be an acceptable amount?
I don't think
amount?
We're going to get an insane bid, but for
what
me...
What would be, for me, for you, what would be an acceptable amount to sell him for?
It depends what you mean by acceptable, as in a realistic amount, and what you mean as something that would actually make you want a seller.
I think, for me, I don't think I would sell him unless we're talking, sort of 400,000 to 500,000.
Aye.
For me.
I think that's realistic
to try and get at our level just now, but I don't think undersells his value. If we're going to get offered less than that, he might do more benefit keeping him in the team. Like I said, I don't think we need Scott Allan to get promoted. I think if we got that kind of fee for him, we could reinvest it in the wage budget and build a more a squad with more depth that'll get us through the league.
Talking about a championship club,
him being sold could provide that sort of function for us to grow the squad a bit better.
If you look at 400 grand, at the very least, that's $2,000-4,000 a week players, which in the Championship, you could then argue that you've taken one game changer and you've traded it
for two. Or probably more better in the Championship for $2,000 a week players.
Possibly,
what we'd be lacking possibly is four guys for giving us further depth.
Just giving a bit of depth,
Because you don't need to be signing guys of the talent and potential of Scotland, I think, to get out of this league. Like, we've underinvested in other areas this season and still not being promoted.
So, Mikey, if you were Alan Stubbs, would you be suggesting putting the feelers out a wee bit to see if there was interest in Scott Allen at the £500,000?
Aye, why not? I think it can do us the world of good, and what we can, providing he has the solutions potentially lined up for what he'd like to bring in, I'd happily start, like, you know, start the bidding, if you like.
It's funny because it goes against,
when you look at someone like
McLeod
went for £800,000. And I don't think that McLeod's anywhere near as good as what Scott Allen is.
The only problem I would say with the Allen thing is that
he's only got a year left.
It brings
six
up
months.
Sort of, but it also brings up the thing of those fans who wish to have a knee-jerk reaction can have the thing of, well, we've stayed in the Championship and now we're selling our best players. This is the opposite of what we should be doing. We should be tooling up, we should be strengthening. That maybe mentally it would have a big impact on a support that are going to be a bit disappointed at the way that
I think
this
it depends on if it did happen, the sequence of events, like the Stubbs in 3 weeks' time announced three new signings, and then 2 weeks after that we sell Scott Allen, and then we announce another four signings possibly. Like, if it's done in a fashion, like you say, where we can,
it's not
limit
the last
damage
of the window when stocks went out and we realised we were getting.
I think if it's
Darryl
made
Duffy
clear as well, going like Allen, we're allowed to reinvest this amount of money, or some of the money will go back into his budget, then fine. Some Hibs fans will just be reactionaries and go, oh, we're back to the bad old days where we're selling our best players. Like, I think,
just looking at the bigger picture though,
I think that hopefully I think people have bought into Leanne Dempster and will go, right, if she thinks it's the best call along with Stubbs, then maybe it is the best call. Maybe they've got other things lined up that'll utilise that finance.
And that's where Hibs are in a different position than they've been in years, and that you can make a contentious decision and people will, in theory, as long as you can be transparent and substantiate why you've done it, people will give you the benefit of the doubt this year, whereas in previous years there would have been protests outside.
We're going to need to probably cover for a loss in season ticket money. Maybe not cut in half, but we're not going to take as much money in season tickets next year.
I think if Rangers go up, then I think a lot of fans will be like, no, listen, we should,
we can win
in theory, in theory we should walk this.
On the flip side, I think there'll be also the kind of case of, well, do I need to get a season ticket? Like, I can walk up every week.
And that's a game
and
where
not,
the
and not
bigger capacity
money
causes
it. It depends on people's own circumstances, and if they think that, like, you know what, I'm going to get that season ticket, put the money in, stop his budget, that's fine. But I think that I would be more than open to Alan going if it was going to benefit the building of the squad. To be more competitive, like with Alan in the squad, we've still not managed to get promoted because I think we've over relied on him. So we can maybe improve things as a whole by him moving on.
And again, it's the thing of
obviously
with
Alan not though. We
ideal world, you want to keep him and build a great squad.
But again, you can argue that thing of, you know, everyone saying actually Steven Gerrard leaving might be a good thing for Liverpool because now everyone tries to step up to that level. So you could argue the same with Alan. Okay. I'll let you guys deal with the mess of bodies that surround him in the midfield. Connor, do you want to start us and kind of walk you through, almost keep and leave from them? Who would you keep? Who would you be happy to see?
I mean, we were talking earlier, Scott Robertson's pretty likely to leave now because he's out of contract. And, you know, he's been with us for a while. He's been great this year. He's been a lot better. But you would expect him possibly to be one of the ones that moves on. And this is getting down to things as well. Like, you don't want Stubbs to be doing a complete rebuild this summer yet again, as he had to do last year, although he's got a bit more time on his hands this time around. This is where I think perhaps Hamlin and Stevenson maybe should still be around, just for the sake of stability, because it's likely that Robertson's going to go. It's also very likely that Fraser Fivey's going to go, and again, he's an excellent player, but he more or less, well, maybe it was just me reading between the lines, but I saw the interview with him on Alawa when we played Livingston last month.
Yeah,
and
there was a lot about Aberdeen and
he was saying a lot, just like, we'll see what happens. So it's basically, if we get promoted, I'll hang about. If not, you know, I think he'd quite happily move back to Aberdeen. he was talking about them a lot, so you could be almost certain.
The flip side, I'm sure it was Ashton about them a great deal during that.
Well, that too, yeah. But he was very non-committal when it came to
Hibs chat in that interview.
I think in terms of, I would keep Five and McGill if I could. I don't think they'll want to sign. I would keep the both of them.
Unfortunately, we're looking at a much less glamorous championship next year for a lot of these players.
So I would keep the both if we could. But I think they'll go Robertson, take or leave. If he's willing to sign up to a contract that's more financially like sort of reasonable in the championship, I would keep him. But if that wasn't possible, I wouldn't be sort of crying tears over him. Likewise with Liam Craig. For him, he will move on, I think, because just to get some kind of sort of like cleanse himself of like the opinion that's held of him.
It's not been a good move for both things.
It's not worked out.
Well, Craig's coming towards the end of his career he's got to negotiate his final contract, arguably, but he'll probably want some games before he hangs up the boots.
I certainly think he's still good enough to play for us, but I just think for everyone's benefit, it's best that he moves on. It also, if he stayed, it kind of leaves this kind of awkward circumstance of the captaincy. And sort of like how that's going to be viewed, so I think he will move on, rightly so.
I think if he did like a John Rankin or a Wotherspoon and just moved on to maybe, you know, someone like
St. Johnson, or Dundee United
or something, you know, you can see him having quite a happy few years after leaving Hibs. It's just been a bit of a cursed time that he's had for various reasons, and sometimes that just seems to be the way at Hibs for players.
I think the vast majority of Hibs fans don't have the vitriol for him that was perhaps like set reserved for him this time last year.
Most people would wish him well, but it just doesn't seem to be working.
I'd be perfectly happy to see him move on, and a game with the type of football stuff seems to like to play, I don't think he necessarily fits into that.
Slows the game down.
Yeah. And again, whether it's a direct reflection of him as an individual or him as a player, he is one person that you specifically identify with that the most negative of periods for him because he, as a local boy, was put out there as being the acceptable face of the Terry Butcher era. And if that was the acceptable face, you would not want to see the others at that moment in time.
Ryan McGivern, yeah, again.
Yeah, exactly.
He's dropping off in conversation.
The bogeyman.
Yeah.
Right, so
Stanton's the only one really.
I'm a wee bit surprised, I have to say, on the Robertson McGeoch Fivey thing. I have to say, of people who have stepped up to the plate this season, I would say Scott Robertson has done more so than the other two. I think you can argue that he's later in his career and things like that, so maybe the other two are a more sound investment. But in terms of purely looking at building a team for next season, I would say Robertson arguably is the one that you could say, well, we know what he does, we know what he does well. In actual fact, let's just leave him to do that and let's bring in other players around him. Five is the one for me that I can see why people are looking at his capability stepping up, but I actually didn't think he's done anything that tremendous for Hibs. I think he's certainly been overshadowed by a guy like Scott Allen.
They're quite similar players as well.
I think with the Fivey, it was just like it was available, and it's not a bad thing having a guy his ability in the squad just to kind of complement and keep the kind of competition there.
We knew we were short in January as well.
And from his perspective, it gave him football for 3 years rather than sitting in the reserves.
He's a jack of all trades, master of none.
He's one. If I was a Hibs fan, I wouldn't be shedding any tears over the idea of Fivey leaving. Whereas Robertson, like I say, you've kind of suffered through that period of him not really knowing what a player he was, and not really seeming capable of dealing with the idea of playing for Hibs or having returned from England. He's now found that over the last 6 months or so. I think it would be a shame if he was now to move on just as he's found the way that he can contribute to the cause.
I suppose when you put it that way, if you're talking about like a mass clear out in midfield, then it's like, oh, hang on, maybe we should be fine to keep some. But like when you're talking on an individual basis, and it's like, you know,
what he brings to the team is probably relatively replaceable.
I can see that argument.
If we can do a deal that's like not going to kind of cut our throats money wise, then I keep him happily. But because then I don't think it's going to set a sort of negative tone for next season if Scott Robertson is not part of the squad.
I have to say, from an outsider's perspective, I'm surprised at quite how ruthless this conversation is. I thought there generally was more of an acceptance of they started horrendously badly, we've improved as the season gone on. I thought it would be more of let's just keep this rolling over, bring in two or three better players and we'll be alright. There does seem to be more of a
I think we need to question every player and go, do we need to keep them? Like,
do we have, does this person have to be part of next
year's squad? I understand that, but I'm quite impressed with that, because it would be very easy to say, well, over the last 5 months, you know, maybe barring Hearts, we would have won the league, so let's just keep this team. And that, I think a lot of fans, because they become emotionally attached to players, end up doing, you know, they go that way, and it's horrendous if any of their players leave. Whereas there is a much more kind of practical approach to it, I think
that you just say though, like that attachment, it's been probably a long time since there's been, Griffiths aside, mm-hmm. where there's been a number of House players in a squad where people have really went, oh God, I'm desperate for him to stay.
Griffiths is the only one recently
of the last few seasons. Like, other than that, like, I think we've been the that kind of empathy has been like, oh, I'll take or leave him. Of the majority of players at Hibs over the last few seasons, and again, there's nothing dislikable about any of the players in our squad just now. But again, I would take or leave the vast majority of them because of the standard we're at just now, whereby we can, it'd be good if they stayed, but we can also get other players to play at Championship level and probably serve our needs for next season.
I think, yeah, because there's a definite mission for next year.
Yeah.
And I mean, if we don't win the league next year, then there's going to be massive questions asked about Alan Stubbs, and I think this is how he's going to be quite ruthless in mm-hmm. that manner. I think last year he had quite a lot of excuses about the patchwork nature of how he had to do things. I think this time around he's going to be thinking, right, we need to get this right the first time.
At his stage of his management career as well, this could like make or break his career early on if he doesn't get us promoted next season. So he'll, if he has to, make ruthless calls rather than safe calls, because his very fledgling management career probably relies on us getting promoted next year, otherwise he's going to be very damaged goods.
Well, I think you're right, Connor, from that perspective, in that Alan Stubbs really had night to lose this season.
Aye.
And that they started really badly, but no one looked at that as being a reflection on him. It was a reflection of the mess that he had inherited and how late in the summer he had inherited it. Yep. So, and then he was starting badly. Anything had to be an improvement from there. All he really had to do is make the playoffs. And then the fact he got second was seen as a achievement in its own right. Obviously, losing the playoffs, again, is a negative. But I think most people are keeping it in perspective. So next season really is where he'll be judged. Right, moving on to the next players, I'm going to package two up again. Sam Stanton and Danny Handling.
You wonder, like, I mean, again, squad players, you wonder if they would have any major role to play at all next year if we do keep them, other than coming off the bench now and again, or coming in instead of injuries.
What is Stanton's contractual setup?
I think he's got.
He signed a new
both of them got long-term deal contracts.
Well, Handling's
got a mega deal.
Handling's absolutely laughing. He'll be like, just release me if you want. I'll be coining it in.
He must have some incriminating photos of Stubbs and or Dempster.
That was incredibly early into Stubbs's reign as well.
I think the plan was to have like Handling as a first team player, and then we signed Scott Allen. Anyway, you see Handling plays, he plays that kind of 10 role, mm-hmm. or he certainly did when McGee was out injured early in the season. That's why he got a good run of games, and then Allen's one who kind of stepped back into the middle next to, I think it was Craig or Robertson.
If you look at the midfield for the Rangers game, we won 4-0, it was Robertson, Craig, Allen and Handling.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That were the diamond.
He's a very different type of player from Allen, in that like, he's a good link player. He finds space. He's not going to slip passes in, but he finds little pockets of space and he keeps it kind of ticking
around. I think Handling suffers from the conventional view of the position that he plays in. That you normally, you look at a number 10 player and you think they're going to be the stick out in the team. You think that they're going to, you know, change games all the time, whereas Handling is much more of a sensible number 10.
Yeah.
He's a guy who'll keep the ball moving, he'll get involved when he needs to, but because he occupies that area of the pitch, people look at him and think, you should be scoring goals, or you should be creating goals with every pass, and that's the kind of stuff that Allen does, and Handling doesn't, and Handling just is always going to suffer by comparison to those types.
And it might be that, depending on, like say, I'm hanging on this thing, he's going to play 4-3-3. Maybe Handling possibly comes back into the conversation next year in that type of system. Like, he came through the youth system being a sort of guy who came in for wide areas.
Yeah.
So
he came on in the semi-final against Falkirk.
Yeah, no, that kind of second inside left area.
So do we think both of them will stay?
I think so.
Is there any chance that one of them goes out on loan, or two of them go out?
I'd personally like to keep them and try and integrate them as proper first team regulars. I think Stanton and Hanlon have been really unlucky that there's guys in their positions who are clearly more experienced and maybe have that little bit extra. Mm-hmm. Like Stanton, I think, could easily just slot in the midfield next season. Handling, if it's the same sort of diamond formation, I think he can play that role off the strikers, no problem. Just all again, next season it depends what we've actually got available in those guys' positions. If we've got another similarly strong midfield, then that's when it kind of it really starts questioning them. But I think if it's a new team and guys you don't really know what they're about ability wise, and they could quite easily state the claim as being sort of two first team picks.
It's important for their development, I suppose, as well, because they're again players that you look at and you think they're still young laddies, and then actually you think, well, there's players their age who have played 100 first team games by now. They really need to.
When's it going
to
happen?
I think Stanton's really suffered for last season though, and the fact that
he was a bit like Harris, he kind of got thrown under the bus.
Butcher just sort of put him in there because it was what, you know, Butcher never had any other. Well, he did have other options, you know, he had folk like Robertson, you know, Thompson couldn't get near the side. It was pretty much almost fan power, if you want to call it that. They've got Thompson in the team. You know, Stanton never stood a chance. Harris never stood a chance. Handlin as well, to an extent, never stood a chance last season. I think Stanton's still suffering for that, and the fact that he was a regular when we were
everything's going through Stanton last season.
And now that we're good, he's not been able to get the chance to make his mark.
Just wonder if that's potentially basic things with a guy like Stanton, where it's maybe even just his lack of stature. That you look at him and you think, a competitive league with a few teams who are hammer throwers, and you look at him and you think, is he just too easily isolated in that physical battle? I wonder if he actually is a player who would find it easier to play at SPL level, where you're more likely to play games of football rather than going to Central Park and just you know, coming up against a guy like Nat Weatherburn, who is just like the side of a house. And you're just, it is, and it does go back to that Scottish thing of looking at that and going, I know who I'd rather have.
On the flip side, like, these guys in their career, wherever they end up playing, are going to have to play against big bruisers. If they play down in England,
they're going to have to learn to adjust. It's just about the bravery of the manager and, you know, everyone involved sizing up that situation and saying, we'll put our faith that you are big enough or have enough about you to come through that. And I do think that's a leap of faith when there are things that influence your thinking. You look at a situation and you just think, will he get kicked off the park? And Stanton is, I know Alan's not a bruiser, neither's McGeag, but Stanton is so frail looking.
You look at him and you go, like, physically, like, you're a target, I'm coming for you. To unnerve you and stick you right out of the game.
And that's, you look at a guy like Lee McCulloch playing the day, you look at the way that Rangers play the game, and you can see why Stubbs would go, nah, Sam, we'll go with someone else, and we'll put four strikers on that.
And again, like, you're talking about, you know, you're talking about Hanlon and, like, his age and how, you know, he's now becoming something kind of a player. Like, these guys, I think, both are about to become eligible for, like, under 21 level football. Yeah. And they've still got
probably, between
the two of them, less than 100 games under their belt. Like, you question if it's going to happen, when's it going to happen, especially 1 year of that played at championship level, and they've still not really kind of cemented the place. So if they stuck around, fine, but again, I don't think anybody would shed a tear to see either of them go. Not an odd, they must go, but if they went, fair enough, we'll probably find something else, other guys that in the current youth system that would be as good as they are, or bring it as much, but are maybe 2 or 3 years younger and have more development left in them.
But we think they'll probably stay based on circumstances, and that they've got long term deals.
I think they'll still
probably
be there.
I think as well, providing that Rangers go up, there's no Hearts and there's no Rangers, so there's no. So we're the sort of, like, if you want to call it, the favourites for the league next season, which, you know, it takes pressure on us, but takes it off us as well.
You may be able to almost lose a couple of games. You can blood players in games and that.
And, you know, that's why we've had such a kind of strong squad this season, is to compete with those two as much as possible. Next year, it'll be teams kind of like try to compete with us, and I think we'll be in that position better to blood young guys. So we might see more of, like, Lewis Allen and Scott Martin and all those guys, and, you know, I think Forster will be your first pick. And I'd be quite like to see Stanton and Handlin do that as well, right up the middle of the park, those three guys kind of forming the core of the team.
Ultimately, it comes down to the idea that I'd be very surprised if you needed 90 plus points to win the championship next season.
I think the total we had this season was enough to win the league last year.
Yeah.
So it's just,
it will revert
to
type
right
a
now,
wee bit.
Just kind of shows you how dominant Hearts were.
It will revert to type a wee bit next season, in terms of everyone taking points off each other, like the SPL has been for numerous years. Celtic have managed to stay out of that, and that's why they've won the league. The challenge next year will be Hibs trying to assume that position.
Hibs being we'll the Celtic
everyone, yeah, sure. We'll let Hibs everyone else kneecap each other, and we'll stay out of that, and as a result we'll win the league in the end. That will be the challenge for Hibs. Let's look at strikers then. It's another, it's very similar to centre midfield, where there's so many options in a variety of different circumstances. How likely is it that we see all four players next season?
I think Cummings and El Ali will remain.
I think Farid's only signed the 1 year
deal. Well,
I
say a 2 year. They
said 2 years.
Is it 2 years?
Because I think, I mean, I like him, but I think that's definitely a level where he'll be very comfortable as the sort of top end.
Right, he's not an SPL, a Premiership. Because obviously, he scored goals for fun for Falkirk at this level.
Either way, even if it is only a 1 year deal, I think both sides would go into the negotiating table quite happy to get something done. Ultimately, he's sacrificed a lot of season through injury, so he's not really been able to solidify his own reputation in the way that maybe he will next season. And Hibs know they've got a goal scorer in him and a player with quite a lot of influence who seems to be a good influence on the players around him. Jason Cummings.
I think he'll stay around, I think. Jason Cummings definitely.
I think it'd be really solid for him to leave now after one full season. He's done really well, but he's still such a really raw player that
he's a silly thing. He's a silly guy.
Yeah. Like,
I think it's one of these things. Unless some offer comes out of the blue,
yeah,
which we might have to kind of go, all right, okay. The guy cost us nothing. Like, we picked him up 2 years ago.
Similar to Alan though, again, and I think you get into that conversation of where would that offer come from.
And I think Swansea were sniffing about him at the start of the season.
But then, having watched him like we have this season, I think there is no doubt that Cummings is an instinctive goal scorer. The rest of his game, I think, there is serious doubt over. Mm. If you go to the Premier League, you know, you need the rest of your game.
That's why.
Even in the Championship, arguably, you do. So when you're starting to look at where he could go and be a first choice and things like that, you're looking at teams who then probably didn't have the money to actually force Hibs' hand in terms of selling him. I'm not quite sure where these players really fall.
I think he's slightly different from the other guys in that he is that age where there's probably still a lot of development left in him.
I think if it was El Alagui and Cummins up top, Cummins would learn a lot from El Alagui, because he seems to be the type of guy that will be a sort of mentor, you know, he'll help guys on the pitch, whereas Malonga seems a very
introverted.
You know, he seems very much, no, this is me. I'll play for the team, but I'm doing me. I don't really care what you're doing or you're doing. Whereas Farid would be someone who would really help Cummins in terms of his overall game. You know, on the pitch and probably off the pitch as well, considering he's not the sharpest tool in the box.
Right, so is everyone agreed that El Alagui and Cummings will both want to stay on for another season at Hibs, and Hibs will want to keep them?
I would have thought that.
I think it's a mutual thing.
Are we going the other way with the other team?
Well, Malonga, I would like to see stay at, but I know he gets in a lot of fans' nerves, but I think I would like to keep him on. I think he offers a lot. I don't know what kind of deal he's on, sorry, I don't remember.
I think he's got another year.
Details.
And JJ has another year.
If it's possible to keep hold of him.
18 months.
JJ, I'm not sure about at all. I don't think it's worked.
I would sacrifice JJ to give Lewis Allen an opportunity to come into the squad.
Specifically next year, we're probably not going to be quite as challenged. I think JJ is just not worked out. I think Stubbs.
I think he was brought in as a similar, you know, Alagui was still injured. Malonga and Cummins was there.
Malonga was at the Cup of Nations, and
We need somebody just to come in and like fill that void. I think that's what we've brought.
I was just surprised it was an 18-month deal, not an end of the season. You're hoping there's maybe a break clause somewhere on the contract where if we didn't get promoted.
Well, that's
if
the
we're
thing
stuck with
them,
though, like, we might be stuck with him. Like, if he's on an 18-month deal, we might not just be able to say goodbye to him.
But in a Championship where like we say that the general quality will be lesser because they'll be without those two big teams, and you can see a guy like JJ coming in and having a prolonged run in. I don't think he's shown us anything that would say he's going to be a prolific goal scorer, but he probably could contribute as long as there's a guy next to him knocking the goals in. Maybe, you know, he can form part of a team. But the interesting thing is, I don't think either Malonga or JJ are on pennies. I think given where they've come from, I think they're on decent wages. That then the argument, as you say, Mike, is you have to keep going back to, yes, he may be a nice to have, but for the money we're paying, there's probably much more vital places that could be spent. But you're committed to paying him that money. So unless you can find someone to take him.
Potentially looking at, like, do you go between JJ and Boyle? As a kind of, I don't know, like, financially, mm-hmm. Do we try and move on JJ so we get Boyle, who can play as a striker and wide, and then bring in another striker? Like, we potentially need to be looking at going, like, is there somebody in League One who's a goal scorer who we can bring in, who's, like, going to, like, see themselves going, I can make a career for myself right here and be a part-time player who would work their guts out with a point to prove over. I've no reason to think that JJ's not got the heart or the guts or anything, mm-hmm. but do we start looking at going, like, we're a championship side, let's start looking in the league below mm-hmm. and, like, finding that talent and getting a guy in who is raw, who, again, because we'll have other good strikers as first picks, we can invest a bit of time in and making a better player.
Especially if you're talking about a fraction of the wages.
Uh-huh, I guess by all accounts that might be Lewis Allen though.
It might be that maybe four strikers doesn't quite cover it for the season. Yeah. If you know Lewis Allen plus a sort of untested lower league striker plus Malonga, El Agui and Cummings, for me would be a combination I'd be quite happy to go into next season with.
Okay, so I think we've rounded up the whole squad then. To round up this show in general, let's talk about the priorities for the summer. And we can bring keeping players into this as well as signing players. Before we quite get a list together, does anyone actually have any names in mind for the summer? Now, there's no pressure on this because a lot of people say, well, you know, if we need a striker that desperately, who would you suggest?
I'd like to see Messi for Hibs.
I'm no paid to scout, so I'm not really. It's not really important who we think would go into that position. But is there anyone available locally? Is there anyone that you've seen that you think could actually come into Hibs and would be a good fit or would be suited to any of the roles we're talking about?
Danny Wilson would be a good water boy, I think.
I like. I saw a name pop up the other day. Kane Hemmings apparently got released by his club in England.
He's signed a pre-contract with Dundee.
Right. So that, annoyingly, he's been a good player, I think.
So we've got Holt from
I was going to say, like, most of the players that were taken have come from Queen of the South, and they're all signed pre-contracts elsewhere. Like Reilly looks like he's gone to Hearts. Holt's going to Dundee. There's a guy going to Ross County. You know,
that Carmichael's a good wee player. Queen of the South. I wouldn't mind.
I think he's a winger, and might end up needing one of them next season.
Throwing a random one in, Mikey, specifically you, because there's a guy that you brought up before. Jason Holt is not being signed by Sheffield United. Oh, is he a boy that you could see?
I'd take him if he was available and he wanted to come. I'd take him like that.
We're talking in the Championship as well. And again, you've
talking about.
Especially if we're going to get $500,000 for that.
That's what I was going to say. He could come in for Alan.
Exactly.
And then
we're setting a pot of money to get more players into the squad. Whether it would happen or not, who knows? But like, I think realistically, nobody, like, he's been playing quite a bit at Sheffield United in League One. Like, mm-hmm. he's been playing mm-hmm. regularly. Mm. He's
and scoring goals, yeah. But weirdly, Sheffield United have decided they want to go in a different direction.
There's definitely a player there.
And again, it'd be a nice story having Michael Stewart direct between the two teams.
I mean, like,
and he would have a point to prove to
absolutely.
I think if
the deal could be done, then why not? Absolutely. I think that we're probably past the days of, like, can't go between Hibs and Hearts. Like, it's a different sort of kind of era now and things like that, so I don't think it'd be a problem. He'll probably have a pick of clubs maybe more interesting to him than Hibs though.
Hearts will let him go, he didn't really play much at Hearts, I think, this season, and then also went to Sheffield United and they're not keeping him, so you've got to question, like,
that's the thing. I think he's one where his agent has built him up to, you can play at a higher level than this. There's that Nottingham Forest were sniffing about when they were up the top end of the Championship and things like that, but he's now gone towards the top end of League One and they've decided not to keep him, which might actually be a bit of a reality check.
Yeah, and Hearts,
had he had 6 months
up.
ago, he might have stayed at Hearts, but in actual fact that ship sailed, so now he's looking for someone maybe more sensible where he can get more playing time.
I think he was unfortunate with the fact that Jamie Walker got played in a central position and he just sort of, you know, everybody assumed that Jamie, talking first name terms, that Walker was an out and out winger, and he's all of a sudden been played in the middle and he's been a revelation in there.
But then
perhaps,
Holt,
and that's
also
taken Holt.
Similarly to when we're talking about a few like Stanton and Handline, Holt came in and was player of the year for numerous years in the under 18s and we all were just waiting for this time for him to break through, and then we came in, he would play 5 or 6 games, didn't really stick out in his full away again, and you were just waiting for that time where he'd come in for five or six games and just bang, this is the Jason Holt we've been waiting for, now he's undroppable. And because that never came, in the end it was that thing of like, well, if it's never going to happen, we may as well let you go elsewhere. And again, I think he is the perfect example of, if, for example, Dundee United,
he's not trying to sell us your heart rejects.
No, all I'm saying is if, like Dundee United, like we're saying with Craig, if Dundee United sign Holt, I think Dundee United don't have a good player. Yeah. He's the kid, he can be at home there, he'll play away, but sometimes players suffer at the team they've come through at, because you had such high hopes for them. Yeah. When they get in, they're just a squad player.
It'd be
you actually turn your nose up at a useful squad player,
be
because such a fraction of what we thought you would be. Right, let's do our list of priorities for Hibs then.
I'm midfield.
If you could. Right, how many in the midfield?
Three minimum.
Based on
five, McGeoch and Robertson all leaving.
Yeah, based on that,
I think we're definitely going to be down two. Like McGeoch and five, I don't think there's any prospect of them staying. So you're looking at minimum of two first pick centre midfielders.
Right, okay.
And you're looking minimum two first pick.
Of any specific types? Because Hibs,
it's impossible.
This season, for example, I've operated a wee bit more, like we said,
a Piardo type.
Jack Altrade.
Piardo Gomez type.
A guy who maybe
the one bringing up
maybe a guy who can dictate the play slightly deeper, because like Alan, we've talked about how he sometimes drops deep.
More of a kind of specialist holding midfielder.
It doesn't. I don't think like the we require a kind of Matty Jack Bruiser type guy, but somebody who can confidently take the ball off the somebody who can take the ball off the centre halves. From
Bruiser would be perfect actually. He's the sort of player that we should.
Who can start the play from deeper. And then a 10 player can play in those dangerous areas.
Try to combine both roles like Alan.
So somebody like that. And then beyond that, then like there's, you know, we start talking about Football Manager type, you know, midfield players. I think you get the best out of Robertson with him playing further forward than being a holding midfield player. So I would like to see you get that kind of holding midfield player in, where Robertson, if he was to stay, could play further up the park and be more influential. Like, so he played his best football in a spell when we allowed him to go further up the park, and he scored a few goals in the spaces of January, February, I think. So if he were to stay, and we got a guy in who can play that holding role, I'd be happy with that. And then, obviously, there's a lot of ifs and buts, you know, in the Scott Allen situation. But I think definitely two first-pick midfield players, one of a sitting type, I think would be very important. And then, for me, a left-back.
Keeping Fontaines above that for me, I think.
So when Alan Stubbs wakes up tomorrow morning, and he's got over the defeat today, his first thought goes to building almost an entire new midfield.
I think
to
so.
Supplement
if
who
we're
he wants
talking,
to keep.
Like I just touched on, I would keep Fontaine all day long. I don't think we will. And I think that going into next season, we could get promoted with Hanlon and Forster at centre half, but not with the current midfield. If you're asking me what priority-wise...
As in what would be left
tomorrow we need to be getting a midfield in, because we couldn't line up next season with what's left in midfield. We could line up with the two centre-halves we've got, I think, and still get promoted.
Yeah. Okay.
I don't think the midfielders left in contract would get us promoted.
Right, so Craig, second on your list would be keeping Fontaine. Mikey, second on your list would be a left-back.
For the moment, yeah.
Everyone else?
I'd like to see, a winger. Mm-hmm. It's also got Harris to come back, but that's just one. We need another natural winger, guy who can
a left-footed winger as well.
Yeah, just somebody who'll attack the channels and will go straight for the byline, just like a kind of old-school one. Doesn't matter if they can like come inside and use their different foot of that, and just can need somebody old-school, especially if it's going to be with El Algui up front.
Absolutely,
got a big guy up there, you know, big bruiser who can throw himself about, get the ball into him, and you know. Harris might be able to do that, but can't do it on his own. Need somebody else on the other side providing the exact same thing, and also most likely a goalkeeper as well.
Scottish football is a simple place. Michael Higden scored over 20 goals one season. Yeah. So like a big guy is very, very, very useful in Scottish football if you use him the right way.
For me, I think priority is a bit more strength and depth in terms of just squad players in defence. Particularly we've been troubled this year just through losing important players, and because we've got key players and no one to replace them, that's been where we suffered slightly. And let's face it, next year we're going back to Alloa, going back to Falkirk. We keep getting players injured on these bad pitches, and it's something that we're going to have to acknowledge. It's probably going to happen again next year. Mm-hmm. So as great as it would be to rely on Jordan Foster and and the rest of them, David Gray, every week. Even if we keep all these players, you know, it's likely they're going to have spells being injured for one reason or another. So I think, you know, relying less on these key players and just having a bit more depth in terms of defenders particularly. I mean, there are other areas of the pitch where that's troubled us, but to me that's another priority.
I think this is where Stubbs will bring in his because remember when Stubbs came in at the start of the season, the chat between him and Dempster was, we want a first team player for each position, we want a backup player for each position, and we want a youth player for each position. So you're looking at, you know, you're looking at potentially 33 players. Obviously you're 22 that make up your bulk of your first squad, and I think that's where Stubbs will really look at it, and he'll go, you know, if David Gray's out, who's going to come in? Can I get someone who is just as good as Gray, but who's happy at being the second choice? And I think that's going to be a long summer for Hibs, identifying players that are just as good.
I think that's what he's
but happy to be the second choice.
I think intelligently looking at the lower leagues, a guy who will think going to Hibs is an opportunity, and finding a guy who's got enough potential to be possibly good enough to play in the first team, who's willing to take that gamble, but will happily go, right, you know what, I'll wait for David Gray to ping his hamstring again, so I get my chance.
Mm-hmm. Or like that Carmichael for Queen of the South, like him, if we've got a right winger, he can come in and be, he's the backup, but we know he's just as good to go in if, you know, if it's Harris or if it's whoever's in there.
It's basically almost like to a point need to adopt some of the mentality that other championship clubs do maybe, and picking up guys from the lower leagues to flesh out the squad. But we realised we, to appease the fans, probably couldn't do that this season, because there was, like, I don't think anyone in the sporting ambition side of it would have been remotely tolerating us picking up guys for League One. I think maybe if there's more strategy behind it, Hibs fans would be more open-minded to it this year, getting guys to bulk out the squad who are willing, personally in their own lives, like, might have to give up their full-time job to sign full-time at Hibs and take a gamble, and with that brings that real commitment and desire to prove a point. Providing there's somebody that maybe has been identified as being good enough to play at that level. I think that's how we, like you say, talking about the backup element and youth team element. We know that this time last year there was a lot of ruthless decisions made on the youth team. So hopefully whoever was left in it is of a potential that could come in and be a selection next year. I think that Stubbs, again, to appease the supporters and the kind of ambition side of it, probably didn't use the youth team as much as he would like to this year. And has possibly spent this year developing them to play the type of football that he wants to play this year, because I think that probably I don't think the footballing structure of the youth team last year was maybe the type of football that was going to come into Terry Butcher's style of play. So I think that, let me say, Craig talking about that sort of three sets of 11, the recruitment strategy this season is going to be really interesting, I think, going into the summer.
Okay, there was one point there that I'm going to use to wrap up with in just 1 minute, but as we go, final priorities for tomorrow.
Go ahead. final priorities
for Alan Stubbs waking up tomorrow morning.
Alan Stubbs, I guess it's just
goalie.
Who's coming, who's going, and then work from there. Who's leaving? I guess
Don't you drag it out with
someone like Alan. Find out for him tomorrow. Yes. Scott, are you staying? Are you going? Yeah, so Dylan, are you staying or are you going? Just get it. You know, don't. Oh, I want to go on holiday. And make my mind up. No, I want to know now so I can start to plan.
Conversely, perversely, on Monday morning last year, a lot of big decisions were made.
Yeah.
There needs to be the same kind of thing done this year, but in a slightly less kind of panicked fashion.
Yeah.
But like on Monday morning, there needs to be like, you staying or going? Right, thanks. You know.
Yeah.
Move on, and we'll move on and know what we're dealing with.
Yeah, and then, you know, conversely as well, Stubbs needs to say, "I'm afraid you're going. I'm afraid you're going."
Exactly.
So,
yeah.
Like once he knows who's leaving, so I think that's the first priority. Just get things sorted out by the end of May, really, and then, you know, we can start rebuilding the team June, July. Season kicks off early next
Okay,
year, you know.
Final question then, as we wrap up. We spoke a wee bit there about learning from other championship clubs, learning from what other things have, you know, other things that have been done over the course of a season or things that work for other clubs. Hibs will be in a different position next season because not only have they had a season in the championship themselves, but they've also witnessed a full season of other clubs in the championship. Obviously, while it may not please anyone in this room other than myself, Hearts employed some tactics that worked fairly spectacularly, at least early on in the season. When we sat down with Robbie Nielsen, one specific tactic we spoke about was, Craig touched on there, the idea of having one player for a position and a backup. and Robbie Nielsen spoke about his, the fact that he didn't really implement that system. Instead, he had one player for that position and then someone completely different for that position. So he couldn't just keep, if he got two or three injuries, it meant he couldn't keep the same system. But what it meant is that if everyone was fit and plan A wasn't working, all you had to do was introduce one player and you were on to plan B. It just, there was no like for like subs. Everyone presented a different challenge to the defenders. This season is this summer is completely different than last summer for Alan Stubbs, and that he's no looking to supplement a squad that he's just inherited and has to like or lump. Do we think that that is something that Stubbs will go more towards, is having less like for like in a position and more, if he's not working, let's pull him out there, let's put something completely different
and more variety.
I think by necessity he'll be a lot more pragmatic next year. I think we'll be less reliant on key players and, you know, replacements for them. I think it will be, right, we need a plan A, B, C and D, and I think just through experience and just through his last year as a championship manager, I think that's what will happen. I think you'll have a far more pragmatic approach to the game.
And that is easier when you've signed the players yourself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
On the basis that you've signed them for these scenarios where you need plan A and B, rather than purely thinking we need someone better.
Yeah.
Okay, so we've rounded up generally on the squad, a general sense of disappointment, but I think now we've all put it in perspective. Is there an optimism there for next season?
Absolutely.
There's never optimism in the
it's not even tomorrow yet, so I think maybe optimism is possibly a kind of ambitious word to use, but
the atmosphere there today was something different. It was something we could have gone on to talk about, is, you know, celebrating defeat isn't necessarily the best way to describe it, but there's a, I don't know what you describe it as, a kind of understanding of your club where we are,
appreciation of the difference.
Things have changed. It's not, we're still not quite there yet, but things are changing. We've got our club back in a manner of speaking.
Mm-hmm. The structure's there in place to make sure that next season, it's just all about like win the championship. That's it. It's all in place for that to happen. Whereas this season, that was getting integrated, and then after that was done, it was like getting the squad together. Mm-hmm. This next season, that's just the one thing it's focused on, you know, get the team right, get promoted.
As we always like to end on a positive note then, does that actually mean that this summer could be better for Hibs almost? In that, had Hibs gone up, we've already spoken about there's going to be upheaval. This upheaval, most of it would have existed whether Hibs had gone up or no.
Yeah.
But next season, there would have been a far bigger question mark over what you actually needed to achieve. There would be a bigger question mark over what success actually was and about, you know, what Stubbs should be doing in the transfer market, that kind of thing. In terms of us being able to put everything into perspective and going in not with another chaotic summer akin to last summer where you're scrambling about thinking who can we actually get that serves, you know, does the job that we need to do, can that actually be a positive thing for Hibs this summer? They know exactly what needs to be achieved, there's a clear objective, they roughly know who they need to get to do it, and it's as straightforward a summer as that.
I just personally have a lot more faith and the people that are making those decisions this year, mm-hmm, compared to last year. And I think that a lot of Hibs fans will have that same opinion. Whatever calls are going to get made on recruitment, I think that we believe that the people there making those decisions are the best people for the job right now.
And we'll talk more about financial implications and things like that staying in the league as the season goes on. This is generally reaction. It's talking about the main footballing topics that we like to talk about. There will, of course, be things like cutting your cloth accordingly as a result of a second season in the championship. But I think generally from a footballing perspective, we can agree that what this summer represents is the opportunity to take a mulligan on last summer, but in a position where you've got the right people in from day one making the decisions. The fans have got full faith in the process that's going on, mm-hmm, and hopefully we're only without the derbies for a year.
Yeah, I think by and large most Hibs fans, they trust Stubbs, trust Dempster, and I think that alone carries a lot of weight. If we trust what they're doing, then, you know, it gives them a lot of leeway to kind of make the right calls.
And from a positive perspective for the show, it puts us in a position where both teams can have a successful season next season without necessarily being at the expense of the other. Okay.
It'll be quite different. We'll be reporting on different.
No, reporting on Hearts getting beat every week in Hibs.
We could, but like I say, there is that idea of this season one had to fail in the original objective, which was to win the league. Oh. Whereas next season, Hibs could win the league, Hearts could get second, and we could both be in cheese in every single week. So
we'll be playing each other in the playoffs this year as well.
that is true. We'll see how that goes, but either way, thanks very much for joining us on Monday Night Football. We will be back to normal, back in the studio next week, and we'll try and find something to talk about with no football. Thanks very much for joining us. Cheers, guys.
Cheers.